It's the 11th day of July 2016. 7-Eleven. We're going to be live here for the next 4 hours. We have no guest because I wanted to clear the decks out so that we'd have a chance to really get into what's happening in the world today, not just economically, but culturally, and break down all of the latest developments that are unfolding here in the United States as well. I'm your host, Alex Jones. Thank you so much for joining us. There is incredible technology news. There is amazing robotics news. There is over-the-top global government news. There's Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton 2016 news. There's major nuclear news. Why, I've got a BBC article here saying that radiation wasn't so bad after all and that Fukushima isn't a problem. That's even better than the one I heard about Obamacare being free. There's more police departments and police being shot around the country. Oh, there's plenty to talk about dealing with Black Lives Matter. But as a backdrop to all of this, I just want to make the point that humanity is in a deepening crisis. Biologically, culturally, spiritually, we have lost our human identity by design. And I was sitting back last night before I went to bed, and then at about 3:30 in the morning when I woke up and couldn't sleep for about an hour, with just the profound understanding that the evil forces running our planet are out to get the species itself. Everything they do, and their own textbooks and their own white papers and their own statements are about how bad humanity is and how we've got to be culled, reduced, or completely exterminated. And this is being said and pushed by fellow humans. And they just undermine real clean technology. They undermine real innovation. Everything they end up giving us is some twisted aberration filled with Trojan horses. And I'm not being negative saying this. I'm being honest. The positive point here is that we know the globalists are the enemy of humanity. We know whoever they are and whatever runs them. The devil, some mass psychotic psychic link of evil, I don't know. All I know is they're working around the clock to sabotage civilization. Not just to be able to manage it and control it, but because they like seeing poverty and collapse and ignorance and failure. There is a war going on against humanity. Just as the Bible says, the devil comes to kill, steal, and destroy, and is the author of lies. And I look at our world system and I tell you, if there isn't a physical entity, an interdimensional entity, a creature, a group of creatures, if that doesn't exist, then it's about to exist. Because if you look at the genetic engineering and all the chimeras and what's going on, aliens by the thousands a week, conservatively, are being produced by the technocrats on the earth right now. And they've already got AI, which is a new life form. Trying to communicate with people that have been brought up from birth drinking deadly formula, fluoride, and GMO foods, trying to communicate with populations that have been completely reprogrammed by the television and reprogrammed by their computer screens, and to actually see the general population slipping into more and more of a trance state is quite frankly incredible in how horrifying it is. And I'm now 100% sure, and a lot of other people are starting to point this out now, that young people, old people, you name it, suddenly have trouble talking now. Most people cannot write an email that isn't full of typos. Most people have no attention span suddenly. And all of the degeneration of our society is now basically compounding on itself. And we are seeing the soul of humanity being sucked out right now. And because I feel a connection to humanity, it's so horrifying, I catch myself almost wishing that my consciousness would be taken away. And I've never felt like this until the last year. Because it's so painful to see even really smart, awake people starting to dim. And then I can tell over the next few years, they're going to be gone too. And then God forbid my children. Oh my God. Oh my God. I don't know what the globalists are. Well, I do know what they're up to. And it's anti-human. It's super evil. And it's so sophisticated. It's hard to believe it's directed by our fellow humans. And I say that more and more on air because that's just where I'm coming from. It's bad. Now, if I was the globalist, and this goes back 10 years, and I had viral compounds that are basically nanotech that can go in and do basically micro lobotomies in certain nerve center structures of the brain, and I wanted to end free will, and I wanted to incrementally take over, I would slowly poison the population, slowly dumb them down, slowly put out disinformation, slowly confuse them intellectually, spiritually, culturally, and then I would just start titrating the dose up, increasing the level of the poison. As more and more of the public falls to it, those that haven't yet fallen completely to it are still somewhat numb. And our other fellow humans around us are sick. Humans tend to, quote, adapt and overcome, to just accept hardship and war and bad things happening around them, because long term, you would just come out of it by surviving it. But this you don't survive, because it's incremental and from all angles and designed to quietly strangle you over the years, a soft kill. And we've talked a lot about this, but intellectually, when they started coming out and saying soon there'll be anti-stress vaccines, soon there'll be anti-depression vaccines, soon there'll be anti-PTSD vaccines, well, I went and looked them up, and they weren't vaccines. They were live viruses that are basically engineered, so they're artificial, they're nanotech. They self-replicate themselves off your tissue, off of your cell engines. And they're now been testing it on troops for 5 or 6 years and testing it on other people. And folks describe, oh, yeah, he used to be really angry and upset. Now he just comes home and watches TV and does whatever he's told. In fact, it's weird. Bob, it's like he's not even there. And if I was the globalist, I'd go ahead with aerial spray and the rest of it. I'd go ahead and through the pharmacological crops, you know, for decades, they've had bananas and tomatoes and things. They can have actually grow the vaccine as part of their cellular activity so that you're unable to escape it. I would deploy that against the public. And I know they have it. They admit they have it. I shot a video like 8 years ago warning of it called brain-eating vaccines. I gave it kind of a Hollywoodish term, hoping that that would somehow get people to go look at it and find out about it. I mean, this is the fall of civilization. This is the fall of the species by design we're seeing. This isn't, all our modern technologies compounded and we're kind of poisoned and having a problem. We'd work through that. We've already been through that before. No, this is scientifically implemented. And they admit they're implementing it. And there are hundreds of different ways they're hitting us. We should probably have Dr. Nick Begich on to talk about this more in the future, but he's one of the chief chroniclers of these technologies. They're admitted and patented and been tested and been deployed. And they're just trying to get the public at this point prepared and ready to not have empathy for each other as we see the slow ongoing rot of civilization, so that we don't try to reverse any of it, and so we don't try to find out why it's happening or who's directing it and who is exempting themselves from it. The globalists, to a great extent, have tried to carry this out against us but exempt themselves from it. And they argue that even if they end up getting burned by it, it's for the greater good to end the parasite that is humanity. So that this new synthetic silicon-based God can rise up out of our ashes. And see, they don't even have Vice or the New York Times or all the trendy publications make fun of me anymore for that. I talk about it 20 years ago, 15 years ago, 10 years ago, 8 years ago. And it was all a big joke when I had the quotes in my films and video clips of them saying it and their white papers. It was all a big joke. This crazy man says the elite are going to, you know, merge with machines and then wipe out the rest of us. Now you turn on History Channel, Discovery Channel, you read what Ray Kurzweil's saying, you read what all these big globalists are saying, what all the trendies are saying, what all the trendy podcasts are saying. This is all being admitted. And then a lot of Hollywood stars and people, they think they're going to be part of this. If they just go along with it, it's pretty grim. And then I sit back, knowing the history of secret testing that's been declassified, thousands of different programs, in some cases each program exposing tens of thousands, if not hundreds of thousands, and killing thousands. Each program. And that's what they decided to tell us about. And then you want me to take a vaccine when the insert says it can kill me or give me hundreds of different disorders? And I can go do the research work and find out where they produced it? And I know the UN's been caught adding cancer viruses, adding sterilants. I mean, these are facts, people. And I look at the numbers of neurological disorders and cancer and everything. I don't care what color you are. The numbers are all straight up for everybody. I don't care if you're a German from Germany or a Russian from Russia or Japanese from Japan or South Africa from South Africa or you're a Hispanic from Brazil or whatever. You're getting hit. And that's what's crazy about all this. And it's getting worse. And it's on purpose. My uncle almost died from a tetanus shot. My grandmother, 3 weeks after she got the polio vaccine, they said you need to come in and take this new strain. She went in and got the new shot, and a week later got the next strain. And they admit most people in the U.S. got polio from the vaccine. They didn't eradicate it. They spread the thing with it. And they had cancer viruses in it, hundreds of them. One of them alone, SV40, estimated to have infected over 100 million Americans, killing more than 25 million. That's CDC.gov. Go look it up for yourself. Who's running the show? Some bad hombres. Now, let's talk about Black Lives Matter when we come back, because that's only one little plan brought to you by the folks in Tuskegee, Alabama, that told black folks, roll their sleeves up because we got something good for you. This is the ultimate psyop. But if people will just not be emotional, pull back and look at it, it's as naked as they come. And I'm going to break down exactly where this is all going. And I guess it's really just this. I have come to the full understanding that our worst analysis is dead accurate and that it's still worse than we even thought. And that's not a negative thing to say. It's good to know the truth and to make preparation for it. I want to get into Black Lives Matter and all the clips, the latest developments, and kind of the autopsy of what's happening in the next segment because it's longer. I shot a video over the weekend that's gone somewhat viral titled, "This Video Will Bring Down Black Lives Matter." Of course, Black Lives Matter is meant to be brought down in the end. I'm trying to bring it down before it successfully hurts a bunch of innocent people, humans of every color, in every shape, in every size. And I saw a whole bunch of black folks in the video really resonating with it and going, this makes total sense. I remember this. I remember that. He's absolutely on target, you know, talking about different points of history and seeing through it. I mean, it was like half the people or more commenting on it. You could go to their channels were, you know, black folks. And I saw a few people in there who, when you went to their sites, were Caucasian. I don't know if they really were or whatever. And they were saying things like, oh, no, this guy, you know, he works for Israel or he works for the Vatican or he's got an agenda. Don't believe him. I'm not addressing this because that type of criticism does anything to me. That criticism and manipulation is aimed at you, so you stay on the globalist plantation of divide and conquer. It's not racism. Racism is just tribalism. We all have it. We all do it. It's how we're designed. It has its functions when we're really under attack. It's groupthink. It's mob psychology. But it is absolutely important to understand that facts are facts, and you better believe I have an agenda, and my agenda is treating others like I want to be treated, trying to build a good community, enjoying seeing other people get ahead and be successful and innovate and produce art and literature and science. My agenda is to try to wake people up. My agenda is to try to find the words to transcend all this manipulation. Because it's hard to even fight this stuff and not somehow add to it. Especially when the public across the board is so incredibly dumbed down. But it doesn't matter whether I'm a good person or a bad person. I am a very good person. But they could set me up, destroy me, put out a lie to assassinate my character. The issues shouldn't be about Alex Jones. Because I'm not running the world. The globalists are attempting to, and do to a great extent. What matters is the facts I put out that you can go check for yourself. The only way they get away with something like Obamacare being written by foreign banks to screw us over and rob us is to have people not go check the facts. The only way they get away with funding ISIS and Al-Qaeda is to have people not geopolitically be informed and know the facts. The only way they get away with our basic rights and freedoms being destroyed and dismantled is that we're all fighting with each other over idiotic issues that don't exist in the great scheme of things, and the general public doesn't have basic knowledge of how political systems work. The people perish for lack of knowledge, and that's why we're in this position. That said, the useful idiots at Black Lives Matter actually are much, much better people than the globalists that are manipulating them and controlling them. They actually believe they're fighting injustice. They actually have the courage to go out and demonstrate. They have the crazy, wild, misguided courage to go out and, even though they ambush folks, that's cowardly, it still takes some courage to know you're about to get killed. Now, if you're going to do that, it is cowardly just to sneak up and shoot people in the back. But at the same time, still, there's some dumb courage on the back end of that cowardice. It's a sophisticated, delicate point. I don't hate these people, but I sure hate the Ford Foundation, the Carnegie Foundation, the Tides Foundation, George Soros, and the people that know exactly what they're doing. And I look at people like that that enjoy seeing folks hurt, who love punching people's buttons, who enjoy seeing humanity fall, and my dislike of them makes me nauseous. I am beyond hatred for George Soros. What is the end game of the technotronic system? Using the economy, using sociology, psychology, to absolutely, totally, and completely game the global economy, to fix every major stock market, every major currency system, to selectively destroy the language, break down the family. You can see it everywhere. You can see it every day. And here is the boil down of what Black Lives Matter is. Then I'm going to drill into the latest developments. It is an attempt to divert attention away from government corruption, multinationals running our government, all the big scandals, the 2016 election, and to make it all basically racially based, and to create a type of anti-white sentiment that is attached to a lot of legitimate anti-establishment sentiment, and to make revolution in this country not be about restoration of the republic and kicking the globalist out like the British exit has begun to do, but instead making revolution about paying back old scores and reinstituting obsessions with race and religion and ethnicity, and then having local governments capitulate to multinational UN, UNESCO policies enforced by the federal government through block grants and strong cities, federal / UN watchdogs. It is the next phase of the Federal Reserve beachhead established in 1913 of expanding the civil emergency into local government and putting their people in charge at every level. Then the very same Democrats that passed minimum sentencing under Clinton to falsely imprison a lot of black males, which then creates a culture of crime, they go to criminal school. The book gets thrown at them. They go to criminal school. They come out. That's all they know. They don't have the same rights as other people. And then that creates the cycle of not having men in the house and breaking down the family. And the very same cycle is being beta tested everywhere else now. You just see its full implementation, at least to this phase, in the black communities, with devastating effect. And now Black Lives Matter goes out and has its leaders all over the country. We have new videos today, call for killing the police. And they have Miss Alabama call out and say that these guys, you know, are martyrs that are getting killed while killing police. And you have the people leading demonstrations around the country saying kill police. We're going to play those clips coming up. And these people really believe they're fighting a fight against the establishment when the entire thing is run by Facebook, Google, Twitter, the White House, the Justice Department on record, Hillary saying how great it is. Facebook headquarters lit up over the weekend saying Black Lives Matter. This is totally orchestrated to send you out in the streets in a war against local government to bring in federalization and globalization. But when the feds are done winning that war, they're going to absolutely put you in prison and on a plantation much smaller than the one you were already on. And that makes me sick. I don't sit back like some of the social engineers and go, ha ha, look at how hilarious this is. These idiots have no idea what they're doing. I sit here with a nauseous feeling in my stomach. Because what happens to you, I know, comes back on me as well. We're all in this together. The biggest lie the globalists ever tell themselves is that they somehow are going to never have to deal with the things they've done in this lifetime. Truth is, stuff you do in this lifetime comes back on you. And my God-fearing sense, people say, what is God-fearing? When I even think about the perspective of an evil group from their view, I'm not actually thinking evil things in that I'm entertaining them. I run through them militarily. That's what you do as a tactician, getting in the enemy's mind. And when I get in their mind and I actually study them, and I study them long enough to really understand their spirit and who they are, it is the only time I'm scared is when I actually get into their skin and it's like, whoa, oh my God. And I just feel scared of God. Like I want to just get on my knees and start repenting. People ask why I get tears in my eyes. The joy of how good God is, the joy of creation, the joy of all the good things that God's given us is so wonderful. That can bring tears to my eyes. But what really brings tears to my eyes is when I see the master plan and I just wish other people could see it. And I hate to make it about myself. It's just that where are the other people that are prominent that see this? I mean, I've proven I know what I'm looking at. I'm proven I can predict the enemy's operations. I mean, a lot of it's just reading their own writings, but I pull back from it and it's just horrible. But we're so trained to take a side instead of just pulling back and saying, well, in this case, they've got the cops as the good guys and Black Lives Matter as the bad guys, clearly, for logical people that walk through it. But in some cases, they put the police in the spot of the bad guys with warrantless checkpoints and unconstitutional stuff. And then when they go along with that, that makes them the bad guys. You see what I'm saying? But still, they're all pawns in the globalist system, and the globalists admit that. And that's what makes me so angry, is I don't hate a cop, whether they be black or white. I don't hate a woman because she's a woman. I don't hate a Hispanic person because they're Hispanic. I want them to have a great life and be successful and live in love. If they're in a La Raza group and racist and hate me, I see them as a brainwashed mental midget who has to be dealt with. If they're a group of black youth walking by and saying, hey, what are you doing, crackerhead? Oh, we see you looking. You want somebody to, you know, beat you up? I think to myself, man, I don't look like a wimp. I can't believe these are some bold teenagers. This is Texas. Don't they think I have a gun in this car? My God, they're going to get swept up by the cops. They'll be lucky if they're not dead in a couple of years. Man, I wish I could reach out and deprogram them. But you know what? I'm not going to be able to do it here. I can be able to do it on the street corner. Then there's my frustration. How do I reach people? God, that's all I want to do is reach people. People say, what's my agenda? My agenda is to not see everybody get played. I fundamentally, when I've been in parking lots, because it almost happened to me when I was about 16, I later learned about it, that there are these guys that are being parking lots. I've seen them 20, 30 times over the years do it. They're just, you want to stereotype, they're almost always white. And they'll say, oh, man, listen, I just bought this, but they can't let me return it. And it's like a $500 speaker system, and I'll give it to you for only $100 right now. And they're these big, cheap, thin, crappy speakers. And they're just trying to hustle you and sell you something. But I get mad at that, and that's just a scam. If I'm dumb enough, it's not really criminal what they're doing. They see you coming out of a Best Buy parking lot. They know you might be looking for electronics. They want to give you this, quote, great deal. And most people listen and go, yeah, I've been approached by that. Today, in my modern life, it was about a year ago, some guys came up to me in a parking lot, did the same thing. And I said, hey, man, no. Oh, really? It's a great deal. I said, look, I know it's a scam. Oh, dude, what's a scam? The guy kind of got a little angry. And I said, look, go run your scam, man. Don't run your mouth or I'm going to knock your damn teeth out. I said a little bit more than that. And I realized then I wasn't trying to act tough. I wasn't trying to act like a man. I'm not looking for trouble. The guy wants to go around in his baseball cap and his baggy pants and sit there and scam people all day. I said, just take your scam somewhere else. And he didn't like that. Now, the truth is, I wish I wouldn't have gotten mad and gotten the guy's face. I should have. I got more important things to do and bigger fish to fry and bigger enemies to fight. But really, it comes down to that fundamentally. My agenda is I don't like scam artists. People are always asking, what's your agenda? That's my agenda. When I even think about doing something wrong, fear comes over me. When I think about not standing up against evil, fear comes upon me. When I think about taken on the enemy and overrunning them, all I feel is victory. And it's that simple. And for people that have lost their connection to God, I feel sorry for you because it's simple. That's not just genetics or conscience or something built into us. It's spiritual. That you know when something's wrong, you know when something's right, and that's my agenda. And I have tried my best to be the most moral person I can and get this job done. I'm not perfect, though. I hear ads on the network that are not my sponsors that I can't vet or say are good, and I have major moral issues with it. But it's on our local affiliates, too. That's just part of the world. We're in the world. None of us are perfect. And I'm not trying to sit up here and preach today, but I'm just telling you about my personal journey fighting this and researching this and knowing we're losing our free will, knowing our consciousness is being shuttered, knowing people are losing their humanity all around me. And all I can say is, even though I come to you electronically, if you want to defeat the globalist, you have to turn off the phones, turn off the TVs, turn off the sports, and get away from the wireless, and get out in the woods, out in the desert, out in the rural areas. And they know people just instinctively are involved in an exodus out of the cities right now. And they're trying to do everything they can to pass laws and regulations and militarize the police and militarize the BLM to really be mean and really harass folks in rural areas. But I'm telling you, everything in me tells me, get out of the city with your kids. Get out now. Get out now. Get out now. And I sit here and I look at Black Lives Matter. The average police officer on record does have a lower rate of crime, is an honorable person, and is genuinely wanting to help people, and is one of the last vestiges of supposed male defensive prowess. And if we want to know how far we've fallen, our supposed knights in shining armor are the police and the military, and look at how screwed up they are. We're even more screwed up, folks. Look at ourselves in the mirror. And the reason bad people have gotten control of our governments and the police have been turned into instruments of oppression in some cases is because we failed. Look in the mirror. I failed. You failed. We failed. But I'll tell you something right now. The police, when you look at the hierarchy of enemies, aren't even on the list. People like George Soros and that royal family that I on the Wimbledon or whatever, I saw on the news, the royal family, the prince and princess up there at the box while the you know, the UK guy won the match or whatever. I mean, and it's just all fun and cute and non-threatening. These are the people coming after your guns. These are the people shipping TB into the country. These are the people that have old ladies freezing to death in the UK because they can't get their gas allotment in the winter while all of their hundreds of palaces for billions of pounds a year are paid for by taxpayers. Can you imagine having hundreds of palaces and letting old people freeze to death? But don't worry, you go lay wreaths at old people's graves and veterans' graves and talk about charities for old people. It's all sick. I want to get into the news on Black Lives Matter and open the phones up in the second hour, but here's what's fantastic about all this, and I mean fantastic in a bad way. This is what is completely and totally over the top fantastical. We really are watching criminal multinational corporations that have taken over our government. They're doing this to a bunch of other governments right now as well. Look right across the pond, same stuff going on. Just different groups are playing off. They really are trying to shut our energy off. They really are trying to shut our jobs off. They really are trying to shut our industry off. The globalists really are shutting down almost every facet of our civilization. They're attacking our families. They're making it almost impossible to raise our children. They are poisoning us at every level, culturally, but also chemically in the food and water, and writing White House books on how they do it, like eco-science. They're bold. They think we're that stupid. And they're trying to cause a civil war in America over 258 black people that are killed by cops every year on average, when 500 plus die a year on average in Chicago at the hands of other black people. Think about that. And you've got all the major media and the government and the Democratic Party and even some Republicans coming out and acting like, I mean, I've got the quotes from Hillary and Obama. Well, we better reform the police. Well, we better do some listening. Legitimizing some random crazy person going and shooting innocent people. And then they turn around and blame other people who have guns to defend ourselves during this degenerating society that we collectively, the right of individuals, forget what color you are. The real discrimination is taking our rights individually and collectively to defend ourselves. And then it's Hillary Clinton who helped Bill get mandatory minimum sentencing in that has definitely been racist in a big, big way. I'm going to skip this network break. Now, before I go any further, speaking of where do we come from, what do we stand for? Because the mainstream media always makes some issue out of, oh, they sell T-shirts, they sell books, they sell horrible food, they sell shortwave radios, they sell solar systems that are excellent, by the way. Oh my gosh, it's so bad. We don't get our money like from taxpayers like NPR and then beg for money every week. Oh, we don't get it in banker bailouts like NBC and MSNBC, billions to give Rachel Maddow raises. Oh no, we just say, hey, we got good products in the marketplace, very affordable, great nutraceuticals. You might want to buy them from us and fund our operation. Oh, we're so evil. No, I'm proud of our agenda to be self-funded and to grow in the face of the enemy and to be strong so that we can stand up against their attacks. And that we've built a media platform that's growing and becoming more sophisticated and more focused by the day, driven by truth, with a great group of people that I know has providence and God's hand on it and your prayers. So when I do something, again, this is what built any civilization, something special. It's something that I believe in. When I sell storable foods, they are the best quality I can find for the lower price. You could actually probably find something that costs 4 or 5 times more that tastes better and has, you know, better quality. But it's a nexus point, the most food for the best quality. That's what I chose for my family. That's who I went out and got as a sponsor. And then I private labeled it to go even lower, 20 to 40% off. The sale does end today. It will end. InfoWarsStore.com. % off on all the nutraceuticals, unless there's bigger specials like X2. That will end today as well because it is about to sell out. 10% off on everything else. 10% off if you sign up for auto ship on any of those items and free shipping on orders of $50 or more. The Hillary for President shirts. We're going to put aircraft in the skies all 4 days of the RNC and all 4 days of the DNC. We're doing it. You're buying the shirts. At this rate, we'll be able to pay for it by the end of the Philadelphia convention. Thank you. But thank yourself, too. And I mean, in a way, don't even thank you. I mean, we're in a fight. Good. You got a shirt. We're exposing a tyrant. You're putting aircraft in the air. Thank yourself. I mean, we're in a war here. We better use money. It's the symbol of energy. It's a weapon projected at them. Because they're trying to break our will, intimidate us with political correctness, to sit down and shut up. And, oh, after the Civil War, they want to start. We better ban incendiary language by everybody because that's what caused the great riot of 2016 or whatever they're going to do. They've already done it in Europe. I told you, they ship all the Muslims in, cause a crisis, have them start rioting and raping. That's back on the news today. And then just ban Germans and French and others having any free speech. Bottom line, it's very expensive to run this operation. I don't think people would even believe it We couldn't even do this if we were in another state. Texas is the best when it comes to being able to run something like this. We'd be a third the size we were in New York or L.A. Couldn't even operate, basically, in those places. We don't want to operate there. So, take advantage of that sale. It ends today. There's a lot of other specials running at InfoWarsStore.com as well. You can also call toll-free and ask any questions. 888-253-3139. 888-253-3139. 888-253-3139. And it is your purchases, again, that make everything we do here possible. Now, before I go any further, again, I could burrow into all this news. It's all sensational. It's all crazy. It's all really important. And we're going to do it all. But Black Lives Matter and the people that are involved in it that are pushing all of this race war garbage think that they're being bold. They think they have courage. They think they're going after the right enemy. They think they're standing up for themselves, for things they've gone through in their lives. You stand up for yourself by building your own economy and by becoming successful and by transcending oppression and racism that you've gone through and by being a leader that transcends that. You don't become a leader or transcend it by letting the racism or the projected media narrative, the simulation, define who you are so that you're just simply part of your own racist hate group. And let's get down to brass tacks. I've been there. Our crew's been there all over the country. We've shot most of the seminal video. The Hispanic groups that come out are the most hateful, racist, nationalistic, and I'm not saying nationalism is bad, but I'm saying they're very nationalistic, racist. It is ridiculous. The blacks are some of the most racist, out of control, hateful, entitled people I've ever seen, and just attacking and beating people. It's just an excuse for criminals to be on parade with some of the folks that think they're on some special mission. The whites are self-loathing, hateful, controlling, twisted, closet racist, in most cases, who actually get off on the whole spectacle because they're not about building things. They're not about doing things. They're not about transcending. They're about virtue signaling and just kind of leading their own little social justice warrior cult. It's their form of power. They weren't taught reading, writing, or arithmetic. They weren't taught business. They weren't taught how to be charming. They weren't taught about getting into emerging markets. They weren't taught about how to be successful. They weren't taught how to innovate. They weren't taught how to organize. They weren't taught anything but being upset and being victims in the whole victim cosmology. I know people in my life that live their whole lives to be victims. And the pageantry of being the victim and making up how they're victims. And it's like they own a chateau in France or something that they can tell their friends they're a victim and they say, oh, honey, we feel sorry for you. It's like they've been an astronaut and walked on the moon or something. It's like their possession. I'm not here exposing the globalists so you can be in victimology and feel like a victim. And people say, you're just demoralizing us. And I go, wait a minute. Oh, your perspective is as a victim. No. I'm telling you someone's robbing your house. If I see them breaking in your back door, I live across the street because I'm calling the police, I'm getting my gun ready, and I'm calling you because it looks like you're in the house. It's not so you can get on your back and, you know, like a beetle and go, I'm warning you because, listen, I want you to warn me if somebody's breaking into my house. If the dam breaks up the river and there's 5 minutes till 50 feet of water hit me and you hear it on the radio and I'm not listening to the radio, I'm out there mowing my yard. I want you to come over there and say, hey, Alex, the dam broke. Get your kids, get in the cars, get out. Just get to high ground. Not because you're a hero, but because you're alive. All over the country and all over the world. But you can judge a country by how free it is, by how much people render aid. They don't just say on Facebook, give money to, you know, some charity, but don't really give. They actually go out and really help people. And now, all over the West, you hear what we always read about in China and other countries, where there's a little kid just dying on the street, nobody helps him. Because in China, the people have been taught you get ahead by not caring about anybody but yourself. And then when you get drug away to have your organs taken for no reason, nobody cares about you. That's why it can happen, because you don't have a sense that a wildebeest in Africa has. You know, cows, if wolves are coming in to attack them, cows will get around their babies and point their horns out. And cows aren't really known as being, you know, that aggressive or that, but at least they've got that basic instinct, and most of the time it saves their babies. Modern humans, if they were cows, they would sell their baby to the wolf, hoping the wolf wouldn't eat them. Yeah, interruption, my own liner. If you're not aware of the fact that there's an epic battle going on to dumb humanity down, you're not alive, you're not awake. And I know most people are aware of this, but people just want to go do their job, get their kids, go to a baseball game, and then, you know, go to church and be left alone. Look, you're not going to be allowed to run to the country and stay away from this. The globalists are coming for you. And I sat there and thought about this morning. I told Weldon Henson, our shipping manager, good friend of mine, 10 years. He's also involved in a lot of the marketing, but point is, I told him, I said, you know, I was against the Iraq war. I was against stirring up the Muslims. But I understand that they're a very tyrannical, oppressive system, in my view, and very anti-classically liberal. And I said, man, again, I'm going to start videotaping, and I just am always so culture shocked by it. I don't. But I went to two different stores, the small stores this morning. One of them was a doctor's office. I went to get some nutraceuticals I take, but it's not prescription, but you still got to go to a doctor to get them. That's why I'm thinking about coming out with some of the stuff they've got. It's actually kind of a research project. And I went to get that. And it's like glutathione pills. And I went to another store to get a piece for my sink. And at both places, there were Muslim women with full face coverings on, burqas, and in both cases, they were sitting on the ground outside the doctor's office, but in a hallway, and then outside on the street at the little mom and pop store, little mom and pop hardware store. And they were sitting there on the ground, in one case with one kid, in another case with two kids. And man, I realized, and I walked in by the second time, and I saw the ladies' husbands in both cases, and they knew who I was, or something. They were like looking at me and looked completely freaked out. And so I started talking to Weldon Henson, and I said, man, they claim there's only 400 refugees in Texas. Every high school we've called has hundreds. I go, they're all over the place, just everywhere I go. And listen, how xenophobic. There's, you see women with headdresses on and you don't like it. The point is, they're lying to us about the numbers. And he goes, man, I took my daughter to the playground at Circle C, where they have soccer fields. And he said there were over 100 Muslim men playing soccer. He's been in the military. He's been overseas. And he knows what he's seeing. And he said, and just table after table with the women with the hoods on their heads. And he said, yeah, it freaked me out. Absolutely, man. It freaks you out when all of a sudden, boom, all over the place. And they're on the news going, Texas has gotten 400 total. Just like they did in Europe, and it was 5 million. They'd go, we've gotten 100,000, it'd be a million. France has gotten 88,000, it'd be a million. And I'm like, what is the government, what is this? Shutting our power plants off, putting tariffs on us where we can't operate, just screwing us at every level, and it's just, you come to the realization They mean business. And I can tell you right now, folks, these are Sunnis they're bringing in. There are sleeper cells guaranteed, and I'm sure of it. Probably not this year, even next, but down the road, that's how they're going to bring the country down, is with Islamic cells. It's as clear as day. It is amazing. It is amazing. All right, we're going to be opening the phones up for the balance of the broadcast today with a lot of news, a lot of clips. I was preaching or pontificating on the nature of the world and what we face from my perspective in the last hour. If you'd like to chime in on this loss of awareness, this glaze in people's eyes, everybody's talked about it for decades, but it's getting worse. And I've got all these scientific reports that the population is in more and more in a highly suggestible near sleep state, like daydreaming or sleepwalking, that the neurological firings of the human brain, especially in children, are very limited. The higher centers of the brain associated with religious experience, mathematics, classical music, are not even being accessed in most cases. Humanity's being lost. Take this new Pokemon craze that I heard everybody's been telling me about for a week, where I guess Pokemon, you have a cell phone, and you go out and look for these little monsters that you get and you train. You know, I mean, some of my kids play with Pokemon. I know my sister did. She's like 14 years younger than me. I was too young. I mean, I was too old. That came out. After I was doing such things. And so it geolocates where you're at and then puts one of these little monsters that you have to capture and then take back and train in the real world. But because children spend less time outside in the West than supermax prisoners, less than 1 hour a day, EMTs are reporting kids are collapsing everywhere, heat stroke, they're getting hurt, they're running out in front of cars. And in a way, that's good. It's not good they're going to get by cars, but it's good they're outside. It's good they're rediscovering the outside world. But it took the Japanese game brought to the internet to push a system they call augmented reality for the kids to even go outside, where they could have gone and caught fish in the local creek, even if they were in a big city. Or they could have gone and birdwatched or built a fort or played baseball or gone swimming or stolen beer out of golfers' ice chest like I would do. I'm sorry. But, I mean, everybody has their adventures as a kid. Or how about when you're 12, 13, 14, going and knocking on the cute girl down the street's door and having her mom come to the door and say, well, who are you? Well, I met your daughter at the pool last week, and I just want to see if she wants to go to a movie or something. Movie theater's only about a mile away. We could walk, or I got the money. I'll pay for it, man. How about you take us? Well, you are sure are a polite young man. Come on in here. You're only 13. Look like you're about 16. Well, my daughter's 15. Here comes in the daughter. See, that's the kind of video game I was playing, and it was real. And it was a lot better than, oh, I had a Nintendo, and I'd play it when my buddies came over sometime. But the air conditioner with these lights, just in the heat of Texas for some reason, it's so humid outside it's been a little bit hot in here. That's why for TV viewers, you see me occasionally wiping a dish rag on my face. But side issue for the radio listeners, they're not having to watch that. And again, I can only talk about the universe from my perspective. It's not about, well, Alex Jones did this and Alex Jones did that. But I look at the stunted world these children are in. They're not at swim meets. They're not in basketball meets. They're not. No, the vast majority are not. Some are. And you see the kids that are in sports. You see the kids that aren't watching TV all day. It's like they look super healthy, super alive. There's electricity in their eyes. I don't care what color they are. But you see the TV head kids, and they kind of stumble around. They kind of bump into walls. You can't really talk to them. They're always looking down, or they do talk to you. What about this TV show? What about this video game? What about this comic book? And if you go, well, you know, there's more in the world than just comic books, they'll go, oh, yeah, whatever. And like immediately have a Pavlovian angry response to you. Well, if you don't like it, that's fine. I'm like, whoa, whoa. I'm not, hey, you one brought up video games and comic books to me. And you'd think I was awake to all this stuff. I've let my children get ingratiated in it. Some, because, you know, you're going on a trip or on a plane or a four-hour car drive, and you want to go ahead and let them have access to media, or you want them to do research on the internet for their paper they're writing, and then it always train wrecks into something bad. And then you take all the media away from them, except maybe let my kids watch the new True Grit. And it's got violence and stuff in it, but at least it's giving them instincts. It's based on something honorable. It's got good actors in it. It's long form. The scenes are long. It develops a longer attention span. Oh, here, you want to go to the bookstore? You want to go to the library and take 20 books home? Let's do that. Because it gets you to form ideas in your own mind. It gets you to have to image everything you're reading. If you're reading about Moby Dick and what he looked like with all the harpoons and wires wrapped all around him and his big, intelligent eyes staring at Captain Ahab as the two go deep into the sea, interlocked together in hatred. You image that in your mind. That creates synapses. That creates understanding. That creates systems in your mind that came originally from the depths of your imagination and then forces you to access the massively compressed but accessible race memory of every one of your ancestors. It's said, though, that one problem humanity has is that they're unable to pass down the knowledge of one generation to the next. But if you look at the modern system, it's all about blocking the lore, blocking the knowledge, blocking the information, blocking the wisdom, so that you can be enslaved. And I know I've already said that 1,000 times, but that's the key. And that's how you know the globalists are bad. Now, that said, Obama going into his final 6 months in office, 4 months as an elected leader, but another good 2.5 months after that in the Oval Office. And the entire corporate globalist media combine is trying to hype total cultural guilt by everybody and incredible infighting to then have the media and the universities and all the systems roll out their next level of political correctness, where you have to sign pledges to have a government job or sign pledges to be in an even state-funded university or private. That's in the news today. To go to all of the sensitivity training and all of this brainwashing and to reduce the language and to pledge yourself into this new cult. And that we've got to turn our guns in. They now admit it's time to ban the guns. New York Times, Washington Post, Rolling Stone, LA Times, time to repeal the Second Amendment. Thought they never wanted our guns. Now they admit that's what they want. Everything's being uncloaked right now. It's a microaggression to smile at a black person. It's a microaggression to not smile. Brown paper bags are racist. On and on and on. With Hillary and Obama and all the usual suspects saying, yes, it's true. We're sorry. We're bad. White people need to look in the mirror and need to basically listen up, is what Hillary said. That means check it. Oh, you see the cops getting killed? They need to reform themselves. That's separate from a debate about reform. Random people that had nothing to do with these other tragedies around the country are dead, and before they're even cold, Obama is out there adding fuel, and Lynch is adding fuel, which lets you know what you already knew. They're 100% trying to cause civil insurrection in this country which will be used to bring in anti-free speech laws, anti-gun laws. It'll create more racial division, and all any of this does is turn people against each other and create more paranoia and more mental illness. While the big multinational combines steal everything, including the kitchen sink, our birthright, our future, our industrial base, all of us are under attack. All of us are drinking deadly fluoride water. All of us are getting hit with the geoengineering that's going on. All of us are having trouble avoiding the GMO. All of us are under the very same anti-human globalist program. And it's so pathetic to see the media weaponized and the big corporations and the government all together legitimizing that the number one issue in the country is that the police are the bad guys and need to do what the feds say, and that means go under UN control and become political police officers that go out like leftist university officers who let the leftists beat up the conservatives. This is a Maoist-style push to intimidate the country using misguided black people into accepting the next level of tyranny, just as they've done in Europe using the Muslims as pawns. And it is a very, very sickening evil program, and it's out in the open, which shows you how bold the controllers are. Are they bold, or are they scared, or are they just megalomaniacs? We're going to get the number out, get to all the clips and more straight ahead. 800-259-9231. 800-259-9231. Here's another big question. Is America done? I mean, the globalists have taken the most independent, wealthiest nation in world history and turned it into the most unhealthy, obese, dumbed down, indebted nation in the world. We still have a lot of great things in the country and a lot of great ideals. But as we lose the bedrock of what made us successful, is there a point when you can say the country's gone? Because you'd think a Hillary getting elected would finally wake everybody up. No. Her supporters are delusional. They don't care if the actual economy goes down. They don't care if they actually see the nation disintegrate. They want to feel like winners and feel like they're in charge of the country. Coming up, I have a clip of Bernie Sanders saying, oh, we've done a great job, you know, now that I'm going to step down and let Hillary run things. You know, we've won. Everything he claimed he was against is what Hillary represents. Trump is way more populist than her. But Bernie Sanders has always been a dirty fraud. He doesn't even live up to his own socialist dreams, because they never do. Socialist countries always end up going bankrupt or collapsing, even wealthy Western Europe. It doesn't work, ever, unless it's a tribal group of less than 200 people who are in an agrarian area. And then it is a combine, a commune, where you get the word communist. And then people that don't produce as much food or whatever don't get as big a share. And when people cheat handing out the shares, folks get stabbed to death. There are some deaths in those communities. But because it's so micro, it's so localized, it's hard to make it corrupt, because people will kill you. That's how that works. If I'm on a commune and I'm raising cows and I deliver 10 cows that year and I don't get back my share of the meat from the commune, it's fraud. Well, let me tell you, you don't get back your share in one of these globalist communes. You got the whole UN supported, you know, New York Times supported revolutionary grassroots zeitgeist movement with a bunch of pseudo intellectuals dressed in black, going, the computer will decide how much food you get, and we'll all live in big white plastic super stadiums. Oh, that sounds like a dystopic nightmare. But don't worry, a computer will decide what you do and where you live. A computer. Who programs the computer, Dumbo? And then their answer was, you will have to be re-educated for a period of time once the movement takes over and we end all money. And then the person ran around saying that they never said I'd be sent for re-education. It's on the internet, him saying it. To me. I said, I'll be sent to re-education. Yes, you'll be sent to a re-education center. It's in the official resettlement manual of the U.S. Army how to put conservatives and libertarians and returning veterans in, quote, re-education centers. And again, I know I harp on that, folks. That is the totalitarian, the authoritarian name. It is the communist name. The army uses communist lingo. Listen to me carefully. I'm not here saying that what they talk about in resettlement and emergency centers is a re-education camp. They use the term re-education camp, FM3-39.40. How to process your social security numbers, how to run you through it. And it's got dual use overseas and here domestically, but it's for domestic purposes. Go through the manual, read our articles on it. We have the screenshots of the subsections. Yes, folks, you're not in Kansas anymore. That's what I keep telling people. This is so real. A lot of people go, man, the show's more serious. You're more focused these days. Absolutely. It's white knuckle time, boys and girls. They've proven that they're going for broke. They've proven we were right about them. They've proven they were worse than we thought. And the public may be too dumbed down and too selfish and too culturally ruined to be able to reverse it. I mean, their end game of just creating a bunch of dumb idiots has been successful. But there's a silver lining in all this. We're going to come back, go to the clips, send your calls. I'm Alex Jones. The media is teaching social justice warriors of every race, color, and creed that their whole world is about fighting with select government systems that the globalists haven't taken over. They create a social story around it. Sometimes it's true. More than often it's not or just twisted. And then they sick all these groups into the culture to cause destabilization, to not even fix the problem they claim they were fixing, but to hand more power to the UN, more power to the foundations, more power to the universities, more power to the central government. And this should be the biggest wake-up call in history, what we're seeing right now, to see the federal government and the multinationals and the UN monitors openly trying to foment a civil war in this country. I'm going to go to your phone calls after I play these clips. First off, we're ending one of the biggest specials we've ever done on high-quality storable foods, but also optics, shortwave radios, non-GMO heirloom seeds, dozens and dozens of different preparedness items. The bare minimum is 10% off. It's 20 to 40 on all the storable food, 20 off Alexa Pure and Pro Pure water filtration systems, and so much more. Now, this was supposed to end. This was supposed to all end last Monday. I've extended it because of all the unrest and all the craziness that just illustrates why this is important. Then you've got natural disasters happening where local governments and the feds can't even respond or help now. Everybody needs to get prepared. And more, InfoWarsStore.com is becoming a survival center of the highest quality items at the very lowest prices you're going to find in many cases. Sometimes we're not the lowest because that's competitive day to day, but By purchasing with us, you know you're funding the very tip of the spear in the fight against the globalists. That special ends today. X2 is going to sell out in the next few days. So regardless, you get 20% off on that amazing product. Find out about the iodine conspiracy. Find out about iodine deficiency. Find out about why they want to keep lowering the amount they say you need, because it is connected to neurological behavior, all your hormones. I mean, it is just such a game changer. My God. Secret 12 is amazing as well. Just check it all out today. I know your purchase is funding an organization committed as hard as we can to exposing this anti-human project that is the New World Order, that is world government. You can call toll-free, 888-253-3139, 888-253-3139. Independence Day mega sale ends tonight. InfoWarsStore.com or InfoWarsLife.com will take you to the nutraceuticals. And if I sound a little bit more calm and reflective today, it's because I am freaked out that they can have hundreds of publications that they know are writing lies about the liberty media on a daily basis. that they know are lying about Donald Trump, that they know are lying about what the globalists are up to. This whole agenda is just so criminal. And it'd be one thing if they were running a criminal agenda just to be in control, like Boss Hogg, and skim off the top. I'd be against that. But this is a takeover system meant to end us as a species as we know it. That's what the New World Order's plan is. For the globalist, world government is just the beginning. Please see my film. It's free online. ENDGAME. End game. Blueprint for global enslavement. And I know most of you, the listeners, know the film. You've seen the film. You're informed. Our lives depend on the public understanding how serious the situation is. The DVD is $7.95. Every library should have this. Everyone should buy, who has money, 10 copies of this, and should put this in the library so people will see it. My God, I've talked to librarians that have sent us emails and called in where they say sometimes, oh, yeah, I ordered another Endgame or another Obama deception for the library because somebody stole it, somebody broke it, or it got scratched. You know, it was checked out hundreds of times. Or would you consider a program to donate DVDs? Yes, if I had the money or the infrastructure to know all the different libraries. It's up to the listeners to do this. You can get an Endgame. You can get a Obama deception. You can get any of my films, or I don't care, buy them and make copies and give them to the library. Whatever, just give them to the library. And you're like, well, that won't save the world. What will that do, just 100 people or 200 people seeing a film? Are you kidding? Seeing a film like this can change your life. You will see the world leaders admitting they're establishing world government to then carry out the orderly depopulation down to 200 million people. And I go out in public and I see the kids everywhere with neurological disorders and cancer. I mean, we're really walking dead, folks. And then the military simulates to mow down the zombies. They're actually turning us into walking dead as an archetype. And then if things break down, it will be like a zombie apocalypse. That isn't surreal to you? Because the military would go, we're trained to mow down thousands of people begging for food. Oh, yeah. In the simulation, they're now zombies. But let me tell you something. All these entitled people, they will be like zombies if there's a Great Depression. And then, God forbid, you try to defend yourself and your family. So that's why I'm saying get ready. Here's AP article. California ill-prepared for the big one, experts say. Point is that government digs in and has guns and food and everything, and that's normal and good. I say you should be ready, and oh my gosh, that's just bizarre. All right, Michael, Jeremy, Eva, Emmett, Raptor Man. We're going to go to all your phone calls, but since I haven't gotten any clips yet, I've really been remiss today with all the powerful clips. Let's play a few of those right now. This is Portland Black Lives Matter protest, and we've bleeped out the cuss words, with the leader of it, the organizer, going around saying, kill the police, pull out your piece. And, I mean, folks, I go to demonstrate for First Amendment, and there are cops there waiting for me under orders to do one thing wrong, and I'm arrested. But all over the country, especially in leftist strongholds, they let people sit there and say, get your guns out, shoot the police. I mean, that's a call to capital murder. That's like a mafia don saying, you know, hey, capo, tell your soldiers, go kill this guy. You're just as guilty as the don, as the person that pulls the trigger down the line, 10 levels down. Folks, this is protected. And you look at these morons doing this, they have no idea that when, after Black Lives Matter's done causing a civil war, if they're successful, that you're going to be in a federal supermax prison for the rest of your lives. And I take no pleasure in that because I'm probably going to fail, just like others are at trying to stop this, because ignorance rules. The video's on InfoWars.com. I don't even plug my own website. I don't even tell you all the stuff that's up there. It's so important. Video, Black Lives Matter. Protest leader says kill the police and run over them with cars. And then I've got Miss Alabama saying that she thinks this guy that died in Dallas is a martyr. Yes, a martyr for PSYOPs, a martyr for the globalists. Yes, he is a martyr. And people say, well, Alex, you say a lot of stuff's false flag. Why is it this? Oh, it's a false flag. It's a false flag. Sure it is. The media ran the whole artificial thing. They're blaming it on Black Lives Matter. A false flag is just something that's done that's blamed on one group but's really another. Black Lives Matter are just the idiots out pushing the narrative. The media and the president and Soros, they're the ones that launched this attack, knowing full well they put out propaganda like this in the middle of the summer long enough, hard enough, somebody is going to go crazy and go out and start killing. And we knew there'd be copycat shootings after this happened, and that happened. I was criticized on Friday by the media for saying there'd be copycat shootings. That's not hard to know. They know exactly what they're doing, pushing the buttons, pulling the chains, jerking the chains. And I'm just surprised there hadn't been more like that guy up there when they, you know, went into the church and shot the black people. Another wound up loon. Oh, but when that happened, it was horrible and evil. You know, he said he was mad that black people were going around and killing white people, so he was retaliating. And folks said, well, wait, random black people at a church who have nothing to do with what other racist black people are doing, why would you go kill random people? Oh, but the media, you know, they all got that. Oh, it's terrible that he just killed random people. It's the end of the world. Let's blame all whites and the Confederate flag and restrict more speech and do all this. But then when this guy does it, he's a martyr. And Obama and Loretta Lynch and Hillary and all the usual suspects come out and say, better listen up. Hillary said that. Better listen up, white people. Better listen up or you're going to get killed. Better do what the Justice Department says. It speaks for Black Lives Matter. Here's the woman behind it who's about to be president. If we don't stop her, saying you better listen up to what our wound up lunatics did. She's right there telling you, you better do what I say. Cops, you better let strong cities in. Better let the UN run things, then we'll protect you. Then you can kill whoever you want. You don't let us run the show, we're going to burn your cities down. When you and I say, lady, you go ahead and burn it down. And we're going to blame you for it because we know you did it. Because let me give you a little newsflash, witch. I know you told Congress this because it's true. You were begging for more money to fight us and others. You're losing the info war badly. And this little act of desperation has just woken up the police and military 10 times more to the entire paradigm, including their own issues. And so you think you're operating in a vacuum because you've got a bunch of stupid college kids and folks that want to go out and die in some bloodbath, and sociopaths and criminals and lunatics listening to you. They feel empowered because the big TV and the MTV and all the rest of the media has been hyping this culture war. It's totally synthetic. You are going to get the blame for all of this. And anyone who's a thinking person knows what you've done. And you've woken people up like nothing I've ever seen. So I guess I should say to Hillary Clinton, thank you for what you've done because you've woken up a lot of people. But let's go ahead and play some of this video of Portland Black Lives Matter. The video's on InfoWars.com if you want to see it uncensored. We've cut out the cuss words. Here it is.
Why do we have to hold a picture of this mother's baby, this young man here? Clackamas County Sheriff. Oh my God. This is their handiwork. Know your rights, know your laws. And I promise you, if they go about their burden of whatever they said you're doing, you pull your piss out, you bust that. You pull your piss out, you bust that. Because at the end of the day, it's going to be you against them. Yeah. And when we move with the Panthers, trust me, when you see me move, I'm moving in violence.
Now stop clapping. Stop clapping. Stop clapping. Because most of y'all folks ain't involved. Real talk.
We're tired of walking around here asking y'all to help us.
No more asking.
We need action.
Take action. I don't give a whether you knock them over,
whether you run up on them, whatever you do, you better take action.
Let's go. Notice the whites all are like professors and operatives. They know full well what they're doing. So you can actually see controllers there, probably paid to be there. They're all holding up signs. They're supposed to be handwritten. It's the same handwriting. Let's pause it for TV viewers, radio listeners, Infowars.com/show to see the live feed or go see the video. That's all written by the same person. Look at that. They even tried to make it look like somebody else did it. But the A's and the S's and the Y's, it all, and the G's tell you. Look at those operatives. Look at that professor. Guaranteed that guy's a professor. Look at that guy in yellow right there. Look at his Bernie wife. Look at him. Look at the controllers in the crowd. And then you've got their time bomb idiots they've got out front right there with them. You've got the Muslims in the back and all the rest of it just waiting in the shadows. And again, you've got all these mental midgets out there that really believe there's an epidemic of black people being killed. There's an epidemic, and I've got the studies here, even the New York Times had mentioned, of police roughing up black people and driving while black and harassing black folks, mainly because of all the horrible bad behavior and the fact that so many, over the weekend, black men would just pull guns on police. Even the witnesses said this, black witnesses, and they would say, oh, another black man's been killed because they tried to shoot cops. So again, this is the whole psyop to get everybody hating each other, and the police will then treat folks even worse and be more paranoid. And they're all also problems with the police as well. So it's a time bomb. Let's go back to more of this tape.
Let's go!
Disrespect and problems going on by the police against, quote, minorities. But all this is going to do is cause more of that. And if you get into what's happening in many of the inner city areas, there's a culture of absolutely hating the police in general, including black officers, where most black officers quit. Yeah, back it up. It's the kill pigs part. And there's a powerful letter up on Infowars.com by a black officer talking about a decade of living under this and what it's like and how hard it is to then recruit other black officers, because they get into this area where, and it's just like they call people there and then scream and yell at them and shoot at them once they're there to respond to what's already happened. And it's just crazy. I mean, let me tell you, cops have a tough job, one I wouldn't want, but let me tell you, working in an inner city, I don't care where it is, it is scary, folks. All right, let's finish the clip. Here it is. Bernie supporters going around saying they want to kill everybody.
That I know a lot of people are not going to like. I'm a badass black Puerto Rican trans.
Get back! He's got a gun!
He's got a gun!
Mob wants to attack some white devils, I guess. So this is going to unravel very, very quickly. Police arrested Strickland, and he has been charged with 2 felony counts of unlawful use of a weapon. And that's when they reportedly started trying to assault a blogger. So he pulled his firearm out to protect himself. And, of course, the Portland will now probably throw the book at him. He'll never be seen again. And you've just got a bunch of disenfranchised people who don't have jobs, who are going to college and being learning how they've been disenfranchised, not by the globalists deindustrializing the country, not by the globalists dumbing everybody down, not by the globalists shipping their jobs out. No. They just know that the media says the number one problem is the police are attacking minorities. And so now local leftist government with the feds are going to organize them to go out and do this. And when cops get killed, well, the police better start reforming themselves. This is an internal globalist army trying to use useful idiots on the ground to start a shooting war they can use as cover to send in paramilitaries to start overthrowing major cities. I'm telling you. And they've done this in Ukraine. They've done this in Egypt. The New World Order is not playing games. And we either have a total awakening to this, or I'm here to tell you, they're getting ready to go forward with this. And then, of course, the giant third world populations are being brought in. The big think tanks admit to drive down wages, not to help anybody. And all the folks that are out there begging for socialism are going to be just like the people in Venezuela that are now eating their dogs and cats. The country has more oil than the United States. The country has better soil than the U.S. The place should be a paradise. It's not. It was as rich per capita as the U.S. in the 1950s. Argentina was more rich on average. Actually, went and looked up the numbers. I thought it was as rich. Both countries are hell holes now. How those red flags working out for you? Oh, I know. The imperialist pigs did it all. Oh, you mean the big multinational banks that come in and fund socialism and communism in your country so they have one big corrupt government that gets everybody domesticated so they can then bankrupt you? You know who the best debtors ever were to Chase and Goldman Sachs, the IMF and World Bank? Venezuela, per capita, paid back debts better than anybody ever did and paid back more. Oh, Goldman Sachs likes a good commie. Now, this other story is up on Infowars.com. I should have been talking about this from minute one. Very important to get this out. First black Miss Alabama says she can't help but feel Dallas shooter was a martyr. I don't feel sad for the officers who lost their lives. Really, I feel sad for anybody I see. When they had that dart cop in San Francisco shoot the black man in the back who'd done nothing wrong, who was in handcuffs, and then cover it up. I called for that guy to be imprisoned, and he was put in prison only 2 years. That was wrong. And the police lied about what happened and said that he tried to scuffle and take the cop's gun. It was horrible. It's corruption. It's what I expose. But that's the low-level stuff, folks, not all of us having our rights taken, world government being brought in, being medically attacked, all this compartmentalization. And why shouldn't she say he's a martyr? You've got Hillary and Obama and everybody saying, listen up. Yeah, we need to reform the police. Right after the cops are shot, like it's legitimate. Yeah, cops are getting killed because you're not reformed. And the New York Times even has an article out, because statistics are a fact, that police do not shoot blacks on average more than they shoot whites or anybody else. But that they do search them more. And then it has the statistics because, on average, they shoot cops 10 times more often. And why is that? Because in the hood, that's the culture that's been made cool by the media and by everybody else, is kill a cop, shoot a cop, get it done. Just get it done. It's tough. It's manly. Get it done. Get it done. Here, wear these baggy pants. That's what a punk wears in prison. In prison, if you're seen as a female that gets, you know, extra goodies and stuff because you bend over for whoever gives you $5, that's what a punk is. 30, 40 years ago, punk-ass bitches is the term in prison. Punk-ass bitches have their pants hanging down. And that's why MTV as a joke in the 80s made it cool, and it's still the style, to wear your pants hanging down. So when you get to prison, everybody laughs because you're a punk-ass bitch. That's what a punk is. A punk gets bent over. And so MTV, Sumner Redstone, a big, fat, evil racist, sits there and teaches you how to be a punk and hires these rock bands and hip-hop bands and groups to dress like that. And notice it never goes out of style because you're being inducted. The cops see you. They're trained before you ever dress like that to be cool. This is what a punk looks like. Normally, once they're out, a low-level drug dealer. They're like, if you identify this, this is the garb of a gang. Then the kids wear the stuff to look cool. The cops are like trained dogs to go after that. That's what they're trained to go after. It's like if you're a dachshund that's trained to go after badgers, and a dachshund sees a badger, goes chasing after it. And then they train you how to dress up in a uniform that's going to have the system come after you. Let me tell you, if you're a black person walking along wearing a nice shirt, nice pants, whole nine yards, you're going to get left alone a lot more than you are if you're dressed like a punk. If I dress like a punk, I'd be messed with. When I'm walking around in a sports jacket and stuff, doors are open, everything else, and I'm out in public, I'm watching. You see black ladies, black guys dressed nice. People are opening doors. Yes, sir, what do you need? I don't know where these places are where you see the cops pulling over and arresting you. I'm sure it's going on. The point is that the reason for the whole civil war? Is that the reason this guy is a martyr? No. You've been set up by the media. You've been set up again. The media is run by foreign banks that are raping everyone. Let's play this clip. First black Miss Alabama says she can't help but feel Dallas shooter was a martyr. And I'm going to break. Come back with your calls directly. Stay with us.
Hi, Facebook. I'm just reaching out to everybody because I'm just leaving church.
And, look how scared she looks.
I prayed a lot about everything that's happened this week.
She really believes everybody's been killed.
I can't stop replaying the image of these men being killed in my mind, and my heart weeps. But I think more than anything, I'm dealing with a bit of guilt because
you didn't do what the martyr did. This is mental illness in my view,
because I don't feel sad for the officers that lost their lives, and I know that that's really not my heart.
Hit pause.
I value.
Back it up. We're going to go back and come back. I told you about the lady I know who won't go outside because she thinks the cops are going to kill her son, and she's white. We got 2 hours left in worldwide transmission. We're going to start taking your phone calls right now, and then I'm going to finish up some clips, get into the economic news, the military news. I remember talking about this 15 years ago. It wasn't hard to guess. I mean, it was all over popular culture, but the Pentagon had drones already, obviously. It was going to go to combat robots on the ground, start replacing humans. And they would actually have articles going, conspiracy theorists claims this is happening. That's just what they do to get people not to look at what's happening. Conspiracy theorists say there's death panels in Obamacare. Yeah, we had the subsection. Now it's there. Conspiracy theorists claim you can't keep your doctor. Told you. They just stall you with that term. And I know you know that. But it's crazy. I haven't even gotten into what's happening in Europe with the Muslims. And again, they're now bringing in not the educated upper crust Muslims, folks, who I've known and are really smart, amazing people. I'll just be honest and make that statement. They're pretty smart, informed folks. They're bringing in third world hardcore Muslims that, man, I mean, if they see your wife showing a little bit of her face, they kill her. And it's just head of French police, migrant sex assaults could trigger civil war. That's the plan. Notice all the terms I kept telling you are now in, you know, the New York Times, the LA Times, civil war could happen. Europe, civil, we're like, oh, Alex, quit fear-mongering, saying they're trying to cause a civil war. I know their program. I'm not that smart. Man, they told us what they're going to do. You know, that's why I'm so frustrated at this point. Just look at these articles. Syrian refugee assaults girl 13 at Boston pool. They can't hide that because it's in front of all the witnesses. That's the culture. You want a woman? Take her. It's not that that's old world. I mean, if you're a woman in areas of, say, Italy or something, you're good looking, you're young, you're showing some skirt, you're showing some leg, men are going to hit on you. Hey, let's go out. Come on. I mean, that's what you're advertising. That's what you're showing. The feminists say, hey, don't do that. That's wrong. Okay, whatever, but it's a free country. I mean, I don't really do that. You know, back before I was married or whatever, I mean, a woman, you're sitting there checking out, and I start asking you questions. Hey, what do you do? It's like, well, what do I do? Let's go see a movie, sweetheart. Let's take you out to dinner. Feminists say that's bad, too. But, oh, you want to come over here and just start raping people? That's fine. Karl Lagerfeld is now saying Paris is now a nightmare. Even CNN now admits it's like a third world pit. Oh, you just destroyed your big fabulous thing. You just totally turned it into like a Star Wars space bar scene. Not with all these different cultures and groups bringing, you know, quality, because you didn't bring the quality ones in. There is great diversity to be able to go into an area and have the best Chinese food or the best Middle Eastern Mediterranean food or mouth-watering. I mean, great, yeah. But no, multiculturalism, bring in giant, huge groups and then piss them all off and wind them all up and have the media instigated. Oh, you got screwed over. Oh, you got treated wrong. And the whites are so, oh my God, I'm a minister. I was just raped at the bus terminal by four men. I'm a German minister. I'll cover it up and say it was whites. Because, I mean, you talk about Stockholm Syndrome, freakazoid. And now top designers and just, you know, the liberal elite are like, where's my beloved Paris? It's gloomy and scary and there's it's like Islamabad. Well, I thought that's what you wanted. But it is freaky to walk in a mall and be outnumbered and the women, you can't see their faces. It's like, what the frick? I mean, you know, and you're with your daughters. And you're just, I mean, I started having an anxiety attack. I've never had anxiety attacks in my life. I knew what it was when I was having it the other night. I was actually, because I kept rounding the, I was like, oh, God, help me. And I mean, because it's crazy. It's nuts. Women with freaking hoods on their heads. It makes me want to throw up because I'm a liberal. They make those women do that from birth. It's wrong. They cut their genitals off. And I got to sit there and watch huge motion pictures made where I'm an Islamophobe and a racist because I don't want genitals cut off my daughters. Listen, you bastards. I don't know what your freaking problem is in the New World Order, but we're going to beat your ass. Get ready. Phone calls coming up. Okay, without further ado, we're going to your phone calls. Michael, Raptor Man, Emmett, Eva, Jeremy, right now. And then I'm going to play the rest of the clip of Miss Alabama saying that she feels like the guy that shot the cops in Dallas was a martyr. We just played Black Lives Matter leaders leading the protest in Portland saying, let's kill the police. Let's go out and run them over. Let's kill them. Let's shoot them. And then reportedly they were roughing up or attacking some blogger who was a white, I guess a white devil. And then so he pulls a gun out. So now they're charging him with a felony for pulling the gun and saying, back off. So we have all of that going on. Meanwhile, the Wall Street Journal, police swipe at Obama over tensions. Some law enforcement officials say president has helped sow distrust between police and minorities. Some law enforcement officials say that grass is green. I love how they take the government, the federal government, the media, in open war against local government, hyping the almost non-existent story of police killing innocent black men. I mean, almost non-existent and causes of death for black people. I mean, that's how statistics work. And hyping it like it is the end of the world to bring in UN control. That's official. If you're a new listener, the UN with the Attorney General is openly setting up offices in every city to monitor police. They're suing Joe Arpaio. You cannot make this up. And then by the time it hits the news, it's, well, some police claim Obama's kind of... Obama, I have a clip coming up. In fact, let's just play this down on one of your calls. This is Obama. This is Obama. Compares BLM cop killing to woman's suffrage movement on CBS News. Women's...
One of the great things about America is that individual citizens... and groups of citizens can petition their government, can protest, can speak truth to power.
Truth to power.
And that is sometimes messy and controversial, but because of that ability to protest and engage in free speech, America over time has gotten better. We've all benefited from that. You know, the abolition movement was contentious. The effort for women to get the right to vote was contentious and messy.
Look at that hardcore guy.
There were times when
these guys know exactly what they're doing.
Activists might have engaged in rhetoric that was overheated. And occasionally counterproductive, but the point was to raise issues so that we as a society could grapple with them. The same was true with the civil rights movement and the union movement and the environmental movement and the anti-war movement during Vietnam. And I think what you're seeing now is part of that long-standing tradition.
What you're seeing now, women's suffrage, all of it, shooting random police. You don't even know their names. You just shoot them and shoot some Black Lives Matter supporters, too, while you're at it. Just randomly spray a crowd with bullets. And then the leader of the free world, who won't call Islam radical or won't even call terror attacks Islamic, gets up there on TV and talks about women's suffrage when Hillary's gotten $100 million from the Saudis that execute women that get caught driving cars without authorization. I mean, it's just the most hypocritical, crazy town stuff. I'm going to go to your calls. I'm sorry to give the number out, then I'll go to your calls. In fact, the number is 800-259-9231, 800-259-9231. Just make your point. I want to hear from you. I want to get to the next person, and then we'll take calls right into the next hour when one of the other great hosts comes in. I know they plan to take a lot of calls. David Knight, I want him to take a ton of calls. He has me taking a ton of calls. I got a lot more to get to here, but this is a plan, and it's just outrageous that they sit there this cynically and do this. I mean, that is crazy. And they are letting Black Lives Matter call for killing police all over the country. In fact, it's basically time for citizens' arrest. I mean, I'm surprised they arrested that blogger when folks tried to assault him. He pulled out a handgun and said, get back. That's all he said. I mean, I got to say, if I'm there and I see organized people saying, let's go kill cops, pull guns out, cap them, and let's run people over with cars, I've not been putting myself in that type of situation because I would really try to stop it. I mean, it's people organizing murder. And it's not some love affair with the police. It's a love affair with the country that's on its knees. The people taking us over are as cold-blooded as it gets. If you're a TV viewer, look at that EU minister he's with. Unelected, pure evil. And the guy's smiling, listening to all this. They're doing the same thing with the Muslims there, except Black people are from here and have been screwed over and aren't trying to put hoods over women's heads. I feel so sorry. I'll be honest with you. I feel so sorry for the average Black person that just wants to have a great life and live and love great people. To have the cult or culture attacked scientifically and turned into this and be led by Obama, who is dedicated to making sure Africa stays in the Stone Ages and is dedicated to aborting as many Black people as he can and keeping them as poor as he can to control them. I mean, that guy, I guarantee you, is just anti-human. People, that's crazy. He's Black. How would he hate Black people? Look at that. Look at the globalists that want to kill everybody. Kill white people, too. They want to. They hate everybody. It isn't about color. It's about evil. The ultimate form of control is to be able to starve somebody and tell them what they're going to eat and run their lives. You can't have air conditioning. You can't have cars, he told Africans in a speech, letting his true intentions out. I want you to live to be 500 years old and your kids to people the stars. I just love to envision humans. By then, we'll definitely all be merged into one on distant incredible things, building things we can't even imagine. And if these people have their way, that's not happening because they've already decided you're ugly and you're bad, and they've already decided to get rid of you. Jeremy in Kansas, thanks for holding for 50 minutes. You're on the air. And then we'll go to Michael and Raptor. Go ahead.
This is a dangerous moment, but we the people will make it through to an American renaissance with courage and vigilance and compassion. I'm very concerned right now that the context has been created for a follow-up to the 7/7 American Gladio attack in Dallas that has the resonance with Dealey Plaza and the assassination of Kennedy, with a potential attack this tomorrow, Tuesday, when Obama and Biden and George W. Bush and Laura Bush are all going to be together in a symphony center, which was built by the same engineer who built the World Trade Center. It's Ross Perot's, a business partner, Morton Myerson, it's named after. And so I'm very concerned that loyal elements in Secret Service and FBI and local law enforcement stay aware. It's not about agreeing with Obama's policies, and Obama is no Kennedy in terms of political courage, but we know that there is a spark that's been lit here that we need to put out and then focus on creating an American renaissance with all people of good faith at the table. And so
all right, well, you know, here's the deal. I don't like to speculate on upcoming terror attacks. And when people say this is a false flag, the media pushed the narrative and hyped it, knowing mental patients would do it. The false flag would be staging it and blaming a group they wanted to go after. At this point, the media wants to push it to make the police capitulate and local governments capitulate to a globalist takeover. But we will find out tomorrow. I appreciate your call. Let's go ahead and talk to Michael in California. You're on the air.
Hey, Alex, pleasure to talk to you after about 12 to 13 years. So, man, this thing that happened in Dallas has me a little bit perplexed and some of the other things that surround it. But one of the things I want to get to, right off the get-go, you've talked about a Trump possible assassination. I think the bigger target's actually Hillary. They've got so many skeletons in the closet that you can hear the bones crack every time the door gets closed. But getting on to Dallas, I am very curious to find out what was written on the wall, if anything was written on the wall, because if something like All Lives Matter was written on the wall, that's going to turn everything upside down, and that would tell you why the cops are so perplexed on what he actually wrote.
You know, that's a great point. Why aren't we being told what he wrote on the wall? I should be asking that all day to the listeners. That is a really good question. What do you think? I mean, why aren't they releasing it? It might be some girlfriend's name, and they just don't want to destroy. I mean, I'm hypothetically thinking they don't want to destroy her life by putting that name out.
Well, I don't think that's it. I don't think that's it at all. This almost reminds me. This was before that you were in your teenage years, but I was old enough to remember this, Alex. But in California, when we had the Stockton school shooting, they found all kinds of stuff in the shooter's room that he was staying in. Army men, all this other crazy stuff that doesn't go reported at this point. If you go and look at old articles on what happened in the Stockton shooting in California, which really started what we have now today as far as the new California gun laws. That started at the beginning of that shooting back in Stockton. But they found all kinds of crazy stuff in the room that he was staying in. Now you have this Dallas shooter. You find all kinds of evidence as far as what he was up to. Nobody really knows what's going on here, but the guy was military. He was well-trained. I don't think he was racist. I think it's hard for me to believe that anybody that has been in U.S. military service is a racist. It's very hard for me to believe that, especially after they've been in a combat zone. So I'm really curious of what he actually wrote on that wall, if he wrote anything at all.
It's a great question. We will look into it. And I'm not saying I think it had a girlfriend's name on the wall. I'm just saying hypothetically. I don't know why they would block that. It could be something political. Who knows? But we'll find out. All right, Raptor Man, Emmett Blake, Evan, and many others, your calls are straight ahead on the other side of this break. The sale ends today, by the way, up to 40% off on storable food and a bunch of other preparedness items that funds the broadcast at InfoWarsStore.com. A lot of really interesting angles being brought up by folks about what really happened with the shooting. Here's my issue. We know that this kill the cops narrative is run out of the White House and the globalist media. We know it's being done to make local government capitulate to a multinational system. We know political correctness is about destroying free speech and taking over. And it's going into high gear now, admitting it's totalitarian. So that's why people adding theories to what happened here as if it's its own thing. We already know it's part of the larger false flag narrative of stirring up angry, disenfranchised youths who've been taught they're victims. They've been taught they're losers. They've been taught they have no future. They've been taught the only way to man up is to go out and attack the police. Then the cops freak out and act like goons, back in some cases, and it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy. And sure, cops did bad stuff before as well. It's just an ongoing living the past, Groundhog Day, victimology. The globalists want you to live in victimology, not live in the future, not live in building your own world. And when you have a good attitude and when you're successful, people resonate with that. You're still going to run into jerks. I've run into jerk police and been arrested for no reason, all sorts of stuff. There's big problems. But in this time and season, the globalists are orchestrating this to bring in a major civil unrest / civil war program. We're taking your calls right now. Raptor Man from New York, thank you for holding. Good to have you on with us today.
How you doing, Alex?
Good, brother.
Love your organization's work, man. Hey, there's a Davis report that I did an article on called Security Outlook to 2030, Three Alternative Scenarios. And I'll tell you what, they go from bad to worse. Someone reads this article, reads the report. The scenarios are entitled Walled Cities, Strong Regions, and War and Peace. And it goes into all kinds of details about what they believe the scenario is going to be like going into 2030. It goes from bad to worse, Alex.
Now, which particular government report is that?
It's a Davos report. It's called Security Outlook to 2030, Three Alternative Scenarios. I wrote an article on it on my website.
Sure, but, I remember that. That was was that this year or last year?
It was last year, yeah, when they had the big Davos meeting.
Sure, I remember that, and it's basically a carbon copy of the 2007 and 2006 Pentagon and British Ministry of Defense reports that talk about there will be a global meltdown, there will be a global shutdown, starting in 2016 and going into 2030, with walled cities, ultra-rich, with robots defending them, everything else collapsed, and billions dying. And, of course, this is actually their war on humanity scenario, but they're going to pose as saviors while taking all the resources in and then using anthropology, sociology, psychology to play off against all the culture groups in divide and conquer. So this is a breakaway civilization and how it basically saves the Earth from the human infestation. So this is the globalists seeing themselves as alien saviors.
Exactly. If you'll let me quote from the document, it says, "The three scenarios may come across as somewhat dystopian because they are extrapolations of existing negative trends." So that's what they think is going to happen.
Absolutely. Read some more of the Loving Report.
Well, I mean, if you look at the artwork on it, you can go right to it there. The artwork is pretty amazing how they do each chapter. The artwork tells you all. But let me define the international security for you as in the document. International security refers to the measures taken by state or non-state actors individually or collectively to ensure their survival and integrity against transboundary threats. That's the beginning of the article.
And so this is 2 years ago, but then Europe advertises, we have open borders, come here, everything's free, rape whoever you want, and then arrest anyone that criticizes it. That's back in the news. So again, they're acting in these reports about these horrible things that are coming while they make sure they happen. Isn't that just special?
Yeah, they never say how they're going to happen, but they just say they're going to happen.
Well, I'm glad you wrote an article about it. I think we wrote one as well. What's the name of your website?
Raptor Man Reports. I actually took your advice and took a man, Noam DePlume, put some articles out.
Well, good.
Thank you,
send us a link. Did we link to your story?
No, you didn't.
Okay, what was the name of your report?
You can link to my story. Oh, yeah, definitely. It's called Security Outlook to 2030, Three Alternative Scenarios. And it's on raptormanreports.com.
Yeah, we found it. And guys, scroll down if we can. Let's actually click on the Davos report itself. Wow, look at the artwork. It's like drone, all-seeing eye robots with a swastika in the compact breakaway civilization with satellites ruling everyone with another all-seeing eye panopticon. And then they've got a technocracy overgrid satellite layout. Wow, man, I tell you, that is unbelievable. Wow. Thank you, Raptor Man, for letting us know about that. Oh, yeah. I'll be honest with you. I guess I am a weirdo. Because I think about humanity in the hands of these mad scientists. And I think about how they have all these Davos reports. They admit they're getting rid of cash to control us. They admit they hate us. They admit they're going to break us down. We're isolated individuals with no family, no community, so they can just euthanize us while they all play God. They're a bunch of wicked, twisted, ugly people. And I just sit there and watch them manipulate the dumbed-down masses of people that have no idea what's even happening to them. It makes me sick. I saw that report 2 years ago when it came out, saw the freaky artwork, and I think I read it in a paragraph in one of Watson's articles. I don't even think we even did a story on it. And it's just this total admission of walled cities, total control, world government, surveillance everywhere. It's literally the intro to Endgame. The first 3 minutes of Endgame is the first warning about what their admitted plan is and what they're going to do from their own quotes. And they put them in white papers after white papers after white papers. With a counterclockwise swastika. With hovering, all-seeing-eyed drones watching the humans. But what it really means is walled cities. And, of course, that's the name of that paper. The walled cities are where the elites live in their compact cities, mainly in rural areas. New cities they're building. And then you go to the next image it has from the Economic World Forum that's committed to improving the state of the world. We have their own internal documents. It's for shredding the world. But if you go back to the first images we were looking at, strong regions means global government. You've got the North American Union, the Asian Union, the European Union. And you've got sub-unions, and then you've got, of course, war and peace. The image of a satellite, ICBMs coming in, tanks. The keyhole through which you see the world. And then you read it, and it's just a hell planet. With the people... are slaves on their knees giving their power to the all-seeing eye pyramid above them. Just the images. And to think that I have been so close to this so long that when they admit it all, I don't even cover it. I get so mad at myself every day when I get off the air of all the things I didn't cover. Thank God I took that caller. See, the problem is I don't take a lot of calls. I make people hold that only folks that are basically half asleep stay on. And then you don't hear all these incredible callers like the guy that just called in. And thank God he took my advice a few years ago and started a nom de plume, started his own website. By the way, this stuff's popular. You take news and information, write stories, you'll get traffic and can make a living off of it. And a lot of folks go, Alex, quit telling all your listeners to do that. There'll be all these new big sites and you won't be the only one and get all the traffic. I would love to be made obsolete and defeat the globalist. You think I do this for money? They're putting hydrofluorosilicic acid in the water on record that lowers the IQ massively and gives you incredible health problems like cancer. We're being murdered. They write about it in textbooks. They are arrogant. Just like they admitted the euro's a tyranny and unelected. And finally, we force the issue. You force the issue collectively, and you see it starting to collapse. We will beat them. Their only hope is to steal the world's wealth, hoard it so we're poor, so that when everything collapses, they control us. And I'm not going to sit here and play games with these people anymore. Listen, get outdoors, take your kids hiking and camping, turn off the television, be healthy, take vitamins and minerals, drink purified water, get right with God, start a garden, start going in with your neighbors and buying a cow and butchering it and saving money. Just get out of the system. That's all I can say. And believe me, none of us are perfect, but all of us can start doing little things like, I'm not going to take the kids and see a Hollywood movie. I'm not going to associate with the establishment. I'm not going to give them my money anymore. I don't need stuff from their system anymore. And look, none of us are perfect. But when you can, pull out of their system. Everything they're doing is about trying to keep you in their system. And I'll expand on this, the special interest today that I'm going back to your calls. We have 20 to 40% off the super high-quality storable foods, the foods I've chosen for my family. We can do it because we private label the great stuff at My Patriot as InfoWars Select. 20% off ends today on Survival Shield X2 Nascent Iodine. 10% off across the board on all the other nutraceuticals. And an additional 10% off when you sign up for AutoShip, things like coffee or Secret 12 or Lung Cleanse or X2 or Brain Force. And free shipping on orders of $50 or more. So take advantage of this today, whether it's Super Male Vitality or Anthroplex or Living Defense or Brain Force or Vitamin Mineral Fusion's amazing. InfoWarsLife.com. We have the joint formula, the bone supplement formula that's blowing people away as well. Knockout's a great sleep aid, natural and really good for you overall. Such great restful sleep. I forgot to take it last night. InfoWarsLife.com or InfoWarsStore.com or call toll free 888-253-3139. And that special ends tonight. So take advantage of that. Thank you all for your support. The Hillary for President shirts are regular price, $19.95. The new design, very handsome, great for men and women to fund this program we have, putting airplanes in the sky. And I'm not going to run this. I mean, I'm going to pay for the flights over D.C. Excuse me, that was a Freudian slip. We'd love to have it there, but they have the air blocked off for any flights over Philadelphia and over Cleveland next week, where I'll be reporting live. But the fellow that's running this, who is a patriot, he's setting up a GoFundMe account that we'll have an article up on Infowars.com soon breaking down. And you can go there, and then we can all pick collectively together cities where Hillary's at, where you can have the Hillary for prison sign. It's already been one of the number one search terms in the country. Been number one for a week once, but been number one the last few months, thanks to your action, my action, and others. And people say, yeah, you really got Hillary's attention. You're really in her face. And the article has gone live now. It is anti-Hillary Air Force takes the skies. InfoWars doubles down after attempt to censor anti-Hillary banner. And that is the final design of the banner. It's the biggest type they have, pulled by larger aircraft. Hillary for President 2016, InfoWars.com. And, of course, they may even try to ban total airspace to keep it out. Then we'll just follow her around the country everywhere and make it a huge national issue that they're censoring this. I mean, that's the whole point. People say, well, they'll censor you. They'll fight back, and then we fight back again. That's how we win. So buy the shirts to pay for the initial campaign, and then if you want to go to the GoFundMe account, there's a link to it there. But it's important to buy the shirts first so you can wear those. They can't censor you wearing those in the streets. Meet like-minded people, especially if you're coming to Cleveland, wherever else Hillary's at. It says legalize freedom, InfoWars.com on the back, InfoWars.com in red on the right arm. Okay, let's go ahead and go back to your calls. I want to thank Emmett for holding from Montana. And then we'll go to Eva. Emmett, thank you for calling.
Thank you, Alex. It's a great honor to talk to you. I love your show. It's been fascinating. But as far as the civil unrest, I kind of wanted to put, you know, a different spin on it. It doesn't surprise me. And you and I, you know about this. We've talked about this, or at least you have, you and I. The dumbing down of our education system and the social engineering from first grade on up has created a lot of this. I mean, there are rules in schools. You can't hug your close friends. I always did in grade school and high school. I think that is so we don't lock arms against the new world order. If we're not close to each other, you know. But then they say homosexuality is great, and that really confuses the kid. But then they say hugging your friends, that's homosexual. It's this new world order. Get yourself
exactly. No, no. Can't have dodgeball. Can't have tag. Don't go outside. If they catch your kids playing outside, the police, you know, take them away under orders. This is the end of normal human activity. The domestication, the enslavement, the isolation. They know in every study. In fact, just Google it. Children not held close for hours a day by their mothers and fathers have massively lower IQ and don't even live as long. I mean, people are wrecks that are not, I mean, folks, let me tell you something. Your small children should be sleeping with you at night. They should be up against your skin at least an hour during the day until they're two. People say, oh, I can't stand having kids. You know, they're always clingy and stuff. They are meant to be on you till they're 2 years old. You're meant, I mean, my kids just always are hugging me, always are kissing. People say, man, your kids are so nice. They're so happy. They're always, they love you. What is going on? And it's because I've given them nurture. But I know mothers and I know people who basically can't give affection to their kids because they didn't have it. And again, sir, most formula is 2/3 high fructose corn syrup. It's deadly, full of mercury, lead, you name it. But that's not even the issue. The brain, I mean, you look at the different ratios of human milk, but it's almost all basically fat and then a fat protein and then some sugar. Well, it's almost all sugar. The children are brain damaged. Okay, I'm putting early neglect alters kids' brains. Live science. Read about it for yourself. So that's what's going on here. These children, all of this, the scientists came up with plans 200 years ago in England to create servile minions. And they started putting children in cribs all day long and stopped letting them sleep with their parents and stopped holding them. And this is all part of the death of humanity. Anything else, Emmett?
Yes, absolutely. Of course, the psychiatric medications and, you know, the microaggressions. You can't have a peanut butter and jelly sandwich. It'll offend the black people at your school. So the kids can't think straight. So they go out screaming about the police, screaming Black Lives Matter. And there are a lot of white kids, you know, teenagers, young adults, who've been brainwashed by the education system, and they don't even know how to think straight. They don't go outside, or, you know, they don't know history. I mean, 50 years ago or 60 years ago, they wouldn't have been, you know, I don't know how to bought into this. They wouldn't have bought into all these lies and all these high
schools. And imagine
they were able to think critically.
They keep opening and expanding it to literally say, you said brownie, we're calling the police. Well, no, I want brownies. A brownie? You're calling me a brownie? Oh my gosh, peanut butter and jelly. That's what black people like. That's what I like. I used to get that at least once a week, you know, in my school lunch. Mom would send me, like, I'd ask for it. But the point, in fact, I'd get a dessert a lot of times of that, and then also the ham and cheese sandwich. But the point is, exactly, total mental illness where the kids are all, peanut butter jelly sandwich. That is written by psych ward chiefs to create gibbering mental patients. People always call liberals idiots. No, the ones on top are the most savage criminal predators using psychology the world's ever seen. They know what they're doing. It's funny to them. Go ahead.
No, it's horrible. One other thing, I was just kind of, as long as I have you, really happy to talk to you. I'm still worried that they're going to topple Donald Trump at next week's convention.
And that's why we're going.
We want to meet. Yeah, we want to meet Romney. And this is, what are we to do? I mean, they're going to steal our election. I don't want Hillary, but one way or the other, with the brainwashing the schools, whatever happens, there's going to be blood in the streets. There's going to be riots like you couldn't believe, especially if they do nominate Trump. I'm a huge Trump supporter. I really love Trump, but boy, I mean,
well, sir, I'm going to be there covering it, but you're absolutely right. It's an epic time to be alive. Listen, here's the deal. We've seen the social engineering they call liberalism. It's not. It's psych warfare to screw society up and turn people into gibbering basket cases who can be put in on their knees with a word. It's mind control with super conditioning, Pavlovian brainwashing. I mean, they admitted it. Thank you, Emmett. And we've got to change course now. The problem is the Republican leadership is part of the same global crime syndicate. And they are racing to finish their plan and complete the dumbing down. And we've just got to rehabilitate so-called liberals. These are cult members. And you can get people out of cults once you are able to talk to them. I mean, look, calling police because someone says they want brownies, or banning peanut butter and jelly sandwiches because they're racist, or banning Halloween parties, this isn't an overreaction of something good. This is scientific mental illness waging war against culture and language and ending debate and human behavior. This is a cult takeover. That's why you see the whole power structure pushing it. People think going out and shooting cops battles the establishment. It's bringing in the globalist takeover that is hell on earth. Eva in Texas, you're on the air.
Hi, Alex. I have an update and a point to make about Black Lives Matter. As you know, Alex, this past Friday, the brave local police chief, African-American of El Paso, Texas, made the statement to the media that the Black Lives Matter is a radical group. Well, he's now being persecuted by some local members here, including the Judge Veronica Escobar and the infamous Congressman Beto O'Rourke, who is the same congressman who denied the Judicial Watch report that we have open borders and that ISIS is coming here. He's okay.
Absolutely. I mean, the police chief came out. We played the clip and he said they are a radical hate group. Well, they are. They're a terrorist organization meant to terrorize local government into submitting to a multinational takeover.
Well, you know, Beto O'Rourke wrote a letter demanding that the police chief be disciplined. Okay? Now, the police chief, the liberal media have been calling him. He's not answering the phones, and he's not backing down. So I wanted to share that with you. Now, the other thing I just wanted to tell you, as you know, many people who have gone on Facebook and have said All Lives Matter, their accounts are removed. Well, you know what? All God's children matter. And anyone who has a problem with All God's children matter is satanic.
That's Veritas. Other points?
Yeah, that is all, Alex. Thank you very much for everything you do. You look fantastic, by the way.
Well, you're a sweetheart. I appreciate those kind words. Let me expand on what she just said because it's very simple, but also very profound. Facebook, I mean, that's admitted, but it just hit me. I've seen that so many times, but it hit me so hard. That Facebook Zuckerberg slammed staff for All Lives Matter stance. Because not only are they censoring people on Facebook that say it, it's happened to us and others. Laura Southern, you name it. But his own people were writing it on a chalkboard, and he slammed them. And you ask, why would he do that? Because in 1984, when O'Brien's torturing Winston, Winston says, the ability to say 2 plus 2 equals 4 is freedom. If I can say that, I can be free. And he tortures him to the point he doesn't even know that anymore. And that's what they're saying. If you can't say all lives matter and all God's children are equal, and that you can let Zuckerberg define that only black lives matter, it has nothing to do with black lives. It has to do with illogic and overthrowing reality. And that's what they're doing. 2 plus 2, they're saying, doesn't equal 4. We got a guy named Ant Farmer that disagrees with me. We'll go to him in a second because I put the people at the head of the line. This is the end. And we got Tom and Mass and Margaret and Blake and others. I'm going to do a little bit in the next hour to take your phone calls. David's going to be taking over as well, but I'm going to go through these calls first. Briefly, I'm going to play the ad tomorrow. It's playing for TV viewers. My dad just retired. He kept his license. He still does dentistry like one day a week, but he's retired from big practicing and management. And I had like 5 of these toothbrushes, the Ghost Smile toothbrushes here, because I was looking at, you know, carrying some of the best toothbrushes out there that are affordable. And when I started investigating these, I learned that they were designed and basically are promoted from right here in Austin, Texas. And it turns out the fellow's a listener and already has a bunch of other businesses and is a famous guy that's developed over 50 major businesses. So I got 5 of these, and my dad's at the office, and he likes electric toothbrushes. And back when he was a dentist, that was one of their biggest profitable areas was tooth whitening and ultrasonic toothbrushes. And so my dad, about a week later, comes over to my house. He goes, you got more of those? That's incredible. Where'd you get that? And I said, that's probably going to be a sponsor. I'm thinking about carrying them ourselves. They're really great. He goes, yeah. He goes, the ultrasonic level is like better than $600 toothbrushes we used to sell. And he goes, it's something I always said they needed. It has this ultraviolet light, and it's strong, that kills bacteria while that's going on. And it's just so affordable. And so I've bought a giant mass of these. You can get the second one for something like, well, it's more than 25% off. It's a great toothbrush. When you purchase it, it funds our operation. It's available at InfoWarsStore.com. Now, this is not the regular toothbrushes that are colloidal silver impregnated. Those are good for travel or whatever, and it's good to alternate. You know, I use regular brushes sometimes. I use electric other times. But since I got this a month or so ago or a few months ago, it's mainly what I've been using. And it's also so compact. That's another great part about it. And it's just, it's really is amazing. And it's much better than toothbrushes that are $300, $400, $500. So check it out today at InfoWarsStore.com. Visit InfoWarsStore.com. And try the GoSmile Sonic Pro System today for a limited time. Get nearly 25% off your second GoSmile. I think it's more than that. Pro System as part of our exclusive listener special at InfoWarsStore.com. Using GoSmile, you can whiten your teeth up 7 shades brighter in 30 days. And you're not doing it with the bleaches and things that damage your teeth. That's what my dad talks about in the informational video that we're going to add to the page. Add to the page of InfoWars Store here in the next hour or so, so you can actually see him do demonstrations. But we go out and find the best stuff out there and try to discount it for you. And it has the Ghost Smile Tooth Whitening Gel that, again, is not damaging to the teeth, unlike so many other gels. So that's why my dad, who's also an oral surgeon and taught dentistry at the college level at Baylor, is just so crazy about it. So it's good to have him. You know, he's involved in some of the nutraceutical development with us. Because he's done that before with stuff that's been approved by the FDA. We're not going that route, but that's why he's good for all the FDA compliance and things. That's really his job with the lawyers, is to make sure that's all super kosher and we doctor group test everything three times. His suppliers test things, then we test things again. Just to be super neurotic, that's his main job. But it's kind of funny because my dad's a pretty private guy, and he looks like Colonel Sanders or something up there. I wish he'd cut that. He's had a beard for about 20 years. He likes it. I don't know why he has it. I'm not knocking him here on air. Just he looks more like me. I look more like him. He's a handsome guy with that beard. I think I'm going to wait till he's asleep one night and sneak in with some shears and cut it off. But now he's had it 20-something years. My kids all know him with it. He cut it off about 6 months ago, and the whole family's like, whoa, David, you don't have the beard. It used to be a full beard. Back before that was cool, like 15 years ago, he had the beard. Then he went to the little goatee and the Colonel Sanders look. And so the truth is, I'm not just Bill Hicks. I'm actually a clone of Colonel Sanders. He's the first clone of the original Colonel Sanders. Get the toothbrush at InfoWarsStore.com or come back and take a few calls. Stay with us. Ant Farmer, who disagrees. Go ahead, Ant Farmer, you're on the air.
Alex, rather than thanking you like everybody else does, I'd like to know, how do you have multiple articles, multiple shows, specifically about cell phone and cancer, yet you make your listeners wait for almost an hour?
Well, I have never said that I'm not a hypocrite, but I think that hypocritical argument you just put out is crazy. How is it my fault that you are on a cell phone if you made that decision and not a landline? Or let's go further. I only made you hold like 5 minutes. You were given preferential treatment because you disagreed, and I always want to put the ignorance on display.
Sure. So there's other people that are holding, so I'll get quickly to my point.
Well, no. We're going to hold you over the next segment. Then we're going to get to Tom and Margaret and Blake and everybody, and then to David Knight. But let's lovingly walk through all this, can we? For just a moment. I'll just have people disagree all day. That's really what wakes me up, because I mean, to interface with you is so freaky. You just claimed that I'm a horrible person exposing cell phone radiation, but then I'm getting people to contribute to using the cell phones. I've said Apple's one of the worst companies when it comes to treating its employees and its factory contractors, and I admit that I then have one because it's an easier operating system for me than a Droid, and I use it for limited things, and I think it outbalances, because I use it for good, the photos, the videos I shoot, exposing the whole system. It's like if I'm a soldier on a battlefield and I pick up the enemy's weapon to use it against them, but I point out the problems with it, and I point out the issues, and I say I'm not perfect. So I could see some hypocritical argument there how I'm bad, but how in a million years is making you hold just a few minutes going right to you and that you disagree with me because I am making people fry their brains on cell phones?
I've called in before and waited over an hour, so that puts that.
But you're in a victimology. You're probably a big liberal, and so you're mad that you've had to hold to be on the show. I mean, this is just crazy. You're like bitching about some side issue that doesn't matter. It's a popular show, brother.
Hey, I think I have a right to. I got 5 bottles of DNA Force in front of me. I think I have a right to be able to criticize.
Okay, well, you have a right to criticize me anyway, sir, before you said you have 5 bottles of DNA Force, and I appreciate your support. But hold on just a second. You have a right to call in if you don't buy stuff from us, but let me just say something. Now, be honest. What did DNA Force do?
Hasn't done anything for me yet.
And you really have, you have 5 bottles of it.
Hey, Alex, I quit smoking taking X2. Your listeners know me very well. Can I get to the comparison that I wanted to make between Black Lives Matter?
You can, but you're the one. Hold on. We're going to go over the break. I'm going to hold you because you got a cell phone there?
It's the only thing I have. I work. Am I supposed to use a landline when I'm a tradesman?
Well, no, but you could use... I do want to go more to Skype and stuff, so folks don't have to do that, where they can just call in the main line. I think Skype can... Or they've got computer phones they can call. Sir, I think it's a red herring, but I'm going to shut up, give you 2 minutes when we come back, I promise, to hear about this. I do remember you calling and saying, X2 helped you quit smoking. I don't know how it did that, and I don't know how you can say Brain Force didn't do anything, because you're like, he's got like 4.9 stars. You take 2 of them, I want to climb the walls. So Ant Farmer, I'm going to come back to you. But hey, maybe everybody's different. Physiologies are different. Like I told them when I had surgery a while back, hey, it's hard to knock me out. They said, oh, don't worry, we're using Curare. And the guy came at the end, he goes, no, it took double the Curare on you. I've hardly ever seen that. All right, we'll be back. Stay there, Ant Farmer. All right, David Knight has a really timely guest coming on, an expert on driverless cars, a bunch of Tesla deaths last week. Military robotics makers see a future for armed police robots. We just saw this reported shooter in Dallas killed by a robot. So it shows where all of this is going. David's going to be breaking some of that down and more. If I can be popping in here in just a second with us. But Ant Farmer, and to be fair, I get lost in the shuffle sometimes and make mistakes. He was saying he didn't like DNA Force, that he didn't get any response from it, but that he did from Survival Shield Nation, Iodine X2. Well, then he probably doesn't have nerve damage or other stuff, because DNA Force is patented, over 700 studies. The ingredients in it are patented, like the BioPQQ, the true one, the patented real one you can absorb. They're synthetic fakes that cost more than what we sell ours for. We buy it from Mitsubishi America, just that one ingredient. So that's a neurological super nutraceutical. I thought he said brain force, and he wasn't getting an effect off that. Brain force is strong, and I can't take more than one of them. Some folks take two or three and are literally climbing the walls around here. And it's a powerful nootropic. But I'm going to show about that. Go back to Ant Farmer. Ant Farmer, you said you disagree with me on the Black Lives Matter situation. Go ahead.
And I'll continue taking the supplements, because I don't think you're lying about it. I don't think you're trying to farce people. But I think your best criticism is going to come from people who have been listening to you for 20 years.
Well, I love people that call in and disagree. So just go ahead. I'm sorry.
Black Lives Matter has been around for about 2 years. They've generated tens of millions of dollars. They've had about 1,500 demonstrations. InfoWars has been around for more than 20 years. $110 million has passed through your hands. How many demonstrations have you had?
I think more money than that's come through here, probably. That's an old number. It cost millions and millions and millions and millions a year just to pay for bandwidth. I don't want to tell people how much. I mean, it's crazy. But we're very effective, and we're in an information war. We're changing the narrative. We're exposing larger operations. I've been out to many demonstrations. We've had hundreds of demonstrations. I'm going to Cleveland. I'm actually financing. You have to pay $30,000 for the police. I'm paying $10,000. The check was sent last week. I'm putting aircraft in the air. We just signed a contract to put trucks driving around all day with a huge Hillary for president all over Cleveland. I mean, I'm fighting. So I don't think that's fair criticism. I mean, but why am I being compared to Black Lives Matter? Black Lives Matter has the entire mainstream media backing it, and Facebook backing it, and Google backing it, and the White House, because it's creating division and distracting people of the red herring of police. I used to buy into this red herring of police. I started looking at statistics. Okay, I mean, I've made books, I've made films, I've written books. Look, get to the heart. What is your criticism, Ant Farmer?
My criticism is this, is that we see your face every day, and just like you've said, you've admitted, there needs to be somebody else. It's not me, but I've been funding you, so I have the right to be able to say this without being told that I'm mentally ill or I have some kind of grudge.
I think if you're a mainline Black Lives Matter supporter, something's wrong with you. I mean, is that what you're saying?
Alex, what I'm saying is they're getting a lot more done in 2 years than what InfoWars is getting done in 20 years.
Okay, what are they getting done other than creating massive division, getting innocent people killed, and making the police not respond to inner city areas as crime rates double and triple?
So are you willing to tell me that every single person that you've seen at Black Lives Matter, even the white people, are murderers?
Are we talking about the same issues here?
You just said that Black Lives Matter are promoting murdering cops. Are you being specific to one
person? Yeah, I think the whole black nationalist movement, AP's got an article today, police agencies on edge, on guard amid heightened threats, attacks on police inspired or directed by militant groups. I mean, at the heart of this thing, even Louis Farrakhan, who used to get mad and say, if you kill us, we're going to kill you back. Well, yeah, the person that kills you for no reason, then yes, defend yourself. But even he's going, hey, well, we don't want a civil war. He sees what's going on. This is a plan to set black people up, okay? And so you're having a fundamental disagreement. Black Lives Matter is run out of the Justice Department, sir.
Well, sir, the 60-year-old
What are they getting done?
Woman,
what are they getting done, Ant Farmer? What are they getting done?
the 60-year-old white woman that you see in the protest, she's getting more done than we are getting done in 20 years.
Oh, the woman with the Bernie shirt?
About Hillary Clinton lying and getting away with it over and over. I'm talking about your country bombing people as we speak. Sir, this is no longer about just chat, like you say.
All right, listen, I mean, you're in Canada, and I hear your country. I mean, you know... this is a very illogical conversation, Ann Farmer. Does David Knight, I'm about to let him go and take a few calls and hand the baton to you, but I promise get these calls. You want to say something, Ann Farmer? Am I missing it? Am I wrong? Because I'm not understanding what he's saying. Or maybe I'm missing the forest for the trees.
Well, let me say something about the protests. You know, quite frankly, there's a difference between activism and journalism. We keep a foot in both of those, but we're not wholly one or the other, okay? We do advocate for causes that we believe in. We do take a position. We report things. We report the facts, we try to cover the stories, but that's what we do to wake people up. I think we are having a difference here, but I disagree with him that Black Lives Matter has been a positive influence. They are promoting the kind of white skin privilege that Bill Ayers and Obama and all these 60 radicals that mentored him with the Students for Democratic Society, they all grabbed onto this white skin privilege. That's what I talked about Friday on the nightly news. They have grabbed this narrative. They have used it to foster division, hatred, and rebellion.
Look, the weathermen basically programmed Obama.
Yeah.
And they're now using the exact same playbook, but they're using the media to hype people up to do the stuff for them. It's
yes.
all the same terms. It's the same people.
Bill Ayers stopped
Bill
bombing
Ayers
buildings and he
for
went
the
into
big
education.
Ford foundations. It's all a stinking plan.
Yeah. He stopped bombing buildings, Bill Ayers did, and his Weathermen Underground, okay? They stopped bombing buildings and they went into education. And what they have given us is the Common Core, the programming about white privilege. And what they're doing is they're using it to foster revolution. In Europe, they came after classism, okay? Different classes. They looked at it and they said, well, you know, America is pretty much a classless society, but we can exploit this division between black and white. And that's what they have done. And they said that at the time.
They wrote books about it.
And now we're seeing it brought to fruition. And he was in these institutions in Chicago working
Margaret
with
Sanger
Obama at the same
wrote
time.
Letters and wrote books saying we can't get the blacks. They've got their own communities, their own areas. We've got to buy off all their preachers. Teach them they're liberal, induct communism, and then we've got to break up their families because these things are weeds. I'm so sick of it. I'm telling you, folks, gibbering liberal professors, 9 times out of 10, are the most hardcore anti-human people. They hate black people with a passion. Oh, my God, I'm so sick of trying to explain this. I'm right, period, okay? It's been proven. It's an absolute fact. But they pay people all this lip service, how much they love you. I will talk to everybody straight, just like David will. And I'm just going to throw up. Look. In Africa, the UN will play one African tribe off against the other. In Europe, they'll play Catholic off against Orthodox. They will find the divisions, and there's always some real beefs on both sides, and play them off, okay? I want to take a few more calls. I'm going to skip this network break so we have more time for your calls and David. But, David, we need to do a lot more. We need to do a lot more with them hiring W.E.D. Du Bois and hiring all the black preachers and her quotes. We've got to really educate people because we've got people tuning in and listening. But I tell you, George Soros, the Nazi collaborator, didn't help create Black Lives Matter and doesn't finance it because he cares about people. Tell folks what he set up in Ukraine. I mean, literal first president they put in walks around in black uniforms heiling Hitler.
And he called these color revolutions, and what he's trying to do here is have a revolution based on the color of skin. Okay, all these revolutions that they funded throughout Eastern Europe, they were based on different colors, a kind of tribalism, if you will. But look, this is a pattern that's been going on, and our educational system has been taken over by the federal government. That's what's wrong with it. And now they're moving to take even more control over our law enforcement. That's what's wrong with it.
And it's their training. It's their armored vehicles. Their so-called, this is all the global training.
Yes.
This is what turned our police into this. We're linked up on DrudgeReport.com, a story with the migrants, raping people all over. And it is just a true tragedy that this is happening. And now we have the French police saying migrant sex assaults could trigger civil war. That's been their plan all along. That's been their plan all along, David. And David, again, everywhere I go now, there are suddenly refugees all over Austin.
Yes.
Weldon went to the park. It was like 100-plus men, and the women had to all sit over here. And I go now, and the women are like sitting at the doorstep of businesses on the ground, and the husband goes in. I mean, it's like you tie your dog up or something. I just can't handle it, man. The left, I got to say, because I've never been on the left or right. I mean, they call me a right guy because I'm for guns and stuff. But the so-called left is just a very evil group of people. I mean, they really are. And I'm now realizing it's a lot of even their low-level people know this. They just want power, David.
It's always been about divide and conquer, Alex. And they can't get this done quickly enough with the people that they have here, the divide and conquer. So what they're doing is they're importing people who are going to come in and that in massive numbers, okay? And that's the problem with it. We can't assimilate people. We can't tell if the people who are coming in are even criminals or terrorists, okay? We can't tell. Can't even screen them for diseases. And so what they're doing is they're bringing this in very rapidly, trying to alter the basis of society in order to create conflict because they're bringing the people in such numbers that they cannot be assimilated into a melting pot. They don't want a melting pot anymore in America.
They want a divide and conquer pot.
That's right. And so that's why we've got the open borders. It's part of the globalist move to try to take down the West because, quite frankly, there isn't any opposition to their neocolonialism. Nobody has the strength
China
to do it except the Western nations.
China is open-splicing every creature you can imagine. Everything's going total robot-controlled. The whole world's just falling to pure evil. And despite all of our problems and decadence, we have some of the culture and ideas that will block this dehumanization, and so we must be snuffed out.
Yeah.
The renaissance that ended slavery, the renaissance that worldwide empowered women, they've got to destroy it while they claim they own the mantle to it. It's the most classic takeover program ever. Let's take a few calls here. Who's been holding the longest? Let's talk to Tom in MASH. No. Blake's been holding longer than Tom. Blake, thanks for holding from Texas. You're on the air.
Alex, hey, real quick, I just wanted to respond to something Ant Farmer had said. I'm actually calling you from my cell phone, and I've got a Bluetooth headset. It's just just stethoscope material instead of a cord, and completely blocks radiation and keeps it away. As a matter of fact, I don't think there's a patent on this, so you could probably sell the daylights out of something like that if you ever decided to have.
Brother, you ought to get the patent. We'll license it from you and put it out. That's what we want to. Advance civilization and morals while funding our political ideas, and that's what we're all about, innovation, so we ought to do it.
Well, that sounds fantastic, yeah.
Well, that's his job to either radiate himself or not radiate himself. How is it my fault? It was a very liberal argument.
Yeah, right, absolutely. Right, absolutely, yeah, it's your fault. By the way, too, I'm a doctor. I put a lot of my patients on DNA Force who have statin-induced cardiomyopathy or pain all over their body, and I've had great feedback. I've just told them about InfoWars Store, and everyone goes on X2 also. It's great, great feedback. So anyway, just wanted to get that out there before I got to my main point. But wanted to say, what do you think of this idea? Because I know Roger Stone was trying to get together some speakers. I don't know if he's already got everyone booked. And I know even Donald Trump was looking at getting some people since Tom Brady had canceled on him and Mike Ditka had canceled on him. What about, this is a wild idea, but in light of the Dallas shootings, in light of the way the media is trying to divide everyone and put the idea out that Trump is racist, what about Louis Farrakhan? Having him speak on Trump's behalf. I don't know if he would do it.
Yeah, I don't think he really endorsed Trump. I think he overall said Trump's right that we can't just bring in when Muslims are infiltrating terrorists, just not even vet them and then bring them in. Of course, we got to check them and stop terrorists because that's going to be used to scapegoat all the Muslims. And in the end, they're going to do that too. You know, it's they're bringing in the most primitive third world Muslims who are full of jihadis, and it's going to give all the other Muslims a bad name. I want to believe that Islam, you know, isn't you know, radical in its orthodox areas. But I haven't really followed the whole Roger Stone thing. I'm going to speak next week. He asked me to. We don't need, you know, quote, names of people to speak at some rally for the First Amendment in case they try to steal the Trump deal. The RNC, I know, really puts pressure on people not to be involved with anything Trump, period. They're trying to block Trump getting control of the RNC when he's nominated. He doesn't get control of it until the last day. So there's an internal war trying to shoot down Trump, shoot down his people, tell other Republicans and people don't go speak at this thing. This is about the citizens. Diamonds and Lace is going to be there. I'm speaking. It's not even a, ooh, big deal, a rally, you know, and then, oh, my gosh, I speak to a crowd of, you know, 50,000 people or whatever, 20,000 people, whatever it is. It's about being on the street with the Soros people against them, you know, the Black Lives Matter, the rest of it, forcing our First Amendment, videotaping the speeches, putting it out into cyberspace, and just being there for Cleveland as a force to cover what's happening and to speak out if things are stolen. But people always think one-dimensional, two-dimensional about rallies, rallies, rallies. Rallies are so important. No, putting out news articles that millions of people read every day, videos that millions watch every day, being on radio that millions listen to, and then coming to Cleveland for the First Amendment. It's about the citizens coming. It's about the citizens speaking out. It's about citizens going to Philadelphia and speaking out and pointing out what's going on and being part of the collapse of the dinosaur media. But great points, Blake, and I really appreciate your support and all the things you're doing. Thank you. But yeah, that would be a very interesting idea. Just the media gave the Louis Farrakhan interview that we did almost no attention. It was still seen by millions of people because they didn't know how to deal with it. They want division. And they didn't know how to spin that one way or the other. So that's why they didn't cover that. Going back to David Knight. David, your take on that?
Yeah, Alex, you know, I don't know what Donald Trump is going to do at the convention. My biggest concern is what he's going to do with the vice president. I would very much like to see Jeff Sessions. I don't really know anybody else that he would pick out of the Republican Party that I would feel very good about, because most of the people that are senior in the Republican Party are going to be pushing the kind of globalism and open borders and globalist trade deals that he seems to be at the core opposed to. So unless he gets somebody from outside the political spectrum, unless he gets somebody like Jeff Sessions, who has integrity and who thinks the Constitution actually means something and who's been a mentor to him for the last 8 months, unless he does something like that, I'm going to be very concerned about it.
Sure. What about Michael Flynn?
Well, again, there's an outsider, and I'm not really sure. I know he's a, you know, retired general. He said he was fired because he talked about Islamic jihad, and they didn't want to use those terms. That's a good point. I just hope he doesn't see a jihadi.
Well, here's the word, and this isn't from Stone, but I asked about it. He said, yeah, that's spot on. Sessions is not really at the top of the running anymore, just because all, you know, if he ever spoke at one rally that somebody halfway sponsored, you know, Hillary can, you know, get mentored by a Grand Dragon, and, you know, the Democrat top guy can be a Grand Dragon or whatever. But if, you know, Sessions was ever connected to some, you know, nationalist group or anything, which he wasn't even part of, they could really turn that into something. I mean, Trump came and put out a star on something. They claim it's anti-Semitic.
Right.
So that's one thought against Sessions. I've looked into his history. I really don't see that. But they'll try to spin that like they did Ron Paul, you know, claiming stuff in one of his newsletters. You know, Flynn's right up there at the top of the list right now.
And, of course, there's this concern about Gingrich as well. But, you know, thing, Alex.
Let me tell you, he picks Gingrich, I'm going to have a big problem with Trump.
Yeah.
I mean, Hillary's so bad that I'll still be for Trump. But let me tell you, I am going to be really upset.
Yeah. You know, one of the things that I've tried to do, I've reached out to three different people who are trying to bring up this free the delegate idea. Okay, we've got the guy who filed a lawsuit in Virginia. We've got the lady out in Utah who has the organization. I've tried to reach out to the people who wrote a book, Curly Hoagland, and he's got an op-ed piece out on The Hill today. I've reached out to all of them in the last week. Total silence. Crickets. Come on. Talk to me about it. Let's talk about what the real justice is in this system. Are you going to shut down the votes of millions of people because you say you have a conscience? Let's talk about what a delegate really means. But they won't come on and talk about that. That's,
well, sure, it's total spin where, yeah, George Will says, we are the sovereigns, members of the party. We will decide, not a, you, yes, know, plurality of mere voters. I mean, yes, it was even mere. We're royalty. We're the sovereigns, and you're mere. I mean, actually using the imperial words, and people think that's arrogant. But if you go back to most societies, it was that arrogance that would con everybody to just stand down. We as Americans think of that royal arrogance as ridiculous. But more and more, we worship the royals because the TV told us to.
Yeah.
A lot of these callers have been holding a long time, but David's got a guest coming up. I apologize. We may not be able to get to everybody. KHI says they disagree, so I can give them about 30, 40 seconds here in a moment. But briefly, we only have this day left to get 20 to 40% off, depending on which package it is, on super high-quality storable foods. There's big discounts across the board on optics, shortwave radios, non-GMO heirloom seeds, Survival Shield X2, and there's free shipping on orders $50 or more, and there's 10% off if you sign up for AutoShip. A lot of big specials. That ends today. Take advantage of it at InfoWarsStore.com or call toll-free 888-253-3139. KHI from Minnesota, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Hello, Alex Jones. I just want to share some info, or at least at my constructive criticism with you. I am an InfoWars supporter. I have used some of the supplements that you provide. But I think that what I would like to call you out on is I think that some of your rhetoric on race relations is further dividing what is already a dividing country. I will point out that...
Well, let me just throw this out at you, and you can, we can get your number, we can call you back tomorrow, but David's about to take over, he's got a guest. I said this is a quick call. Eating around the edges and being all kiss butt, oh, I'm sorry, Black Lives Matter, oh, it's okay, blah, blah, they're Justice Department run. It needs to be totally exposed. It's there to hurt people. It's a fraud. It's not going to make the police reform themselves. It's going to make them worse. That's my view. Go ahead.
But I would also say that not every Muslim is an Islamic terrorist. And I think the picture that you paint in white Americans' minds is that every black person is somehow affiliated with Black Lives Matter.
Or no, that is not what I'm saying, but I came across that's not what I intended. If you want, you want to call back in tomorrow, you can get his number, John. Alex David Knight's taking over. Infowars.com. Stay with us.
Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show on this Monday, July 11th, 2016. I'm David Knight. I'll be your host for the rest of the hour. We have a very interesting guest. I've read a lot of his work for a very long time. Eric Peters, he has epautos.com. He's an independent journalist, and he writes about automobiles and mobility and liberty. He does it from a libertarian perspective. He's done this for 25-plus years as a columnist and author. He's worked for places that you'll recognize, like Washington Times, Wall Street Journal, Chicago Tribune, many others. He's got a couple of books, Automotive Atrocities and Road Hogs. His latest one is called Doomed, and I don't know if that's about the drivers, because we're seeing the last couple of weeks there's been a rash of news about self-driving cars causing accidents, one of them fatal. And I would suggest that maybe we ought to stop calling them self-driving, because I drive myself. These are self-crashing cars. I think that's the way we have to start referring to these things as. So we want to talk to him about what's going on with Tesla, the cars. Today we've had a third one, and I want to tell you about this one. This was on the Drudge Report. We've now had a third crash attributed to Tesla's autopilot. And again, that's something that Eric Peters has talked about, the fact that autopilot is really a misnomer. Really shouldn't call it that. Okay. Now, these are beta tests. If you do this in your Tesla, you have to acknowledge that you are participating in unproven software, that you agree with that, that you're going to take the risk to do that, that you're going to follow their guidelines. You know what? I didn't sign a beta release to be on the road with somebody who is doing a science experiment with their car. That's one of the things that I have a problem with. And before we had this rash of self-driving autopilot cars with Tesla, and of course the third one just happened this last weekend. This was in Montana. The guy was going along, he says, at about 55 to 60 miles an hour. He said that he did not have a center line. The car went off the road and hit the wood barriers on the side, and essentially totaled his car, looks like, took off one side of the car. They have survived in this, but we see this over and over again. Even before we had the fatal accident that got so much attention. And again, it was a Navy SEAL. Isn't it interesting that somebody who lived a dangerous life doing all kinds of risky things would be lulled to sleep like Ulysses going on to the rocks by the siren song, be lulled to sleep by this idea of this safe utopian technology. So let's talk to Eric Peters now and get his take on this. Eric, thank you for joining us.
It's interesting, isn't it? There's a juxtaposition between this notion that human drivers are fallible, and we have to get them out of the equation, but somehow technology is infallible.
Yeah.
And I think all of us who've dealt with a PC know that technology is far from infallible.
That's right. It's written by people, right? People who are writing the software, they're okay, but not the people who are behind the wheel.
Well, if you think about this, you think about your computer that's in your home, that's on your desk, it's liable to getting software glitches and other problems, and it's in a very safe, controlled environment. It's on your desk. Now, the computers that control cars are in a moving vehicle that's being jostled around. that's subject to extremes of heat and cold, that's exposed to moisture and all of those other things, and problems are going to happen. And that's, you got that on the left hand, and on the other you've got this touted benefit of these self-driving or automatic driving cars, that you can take your eyes off the road and your mind off driving, and when the car then piles into a semi or an oak tree, somehow it's your fault for not having paid attention to what's going on around you. It's crazy.
Yeah, and that's what we're hearing from Tesla now in the wake of these accidents. Basically, it's not our fault. They misused the technology. We didn't make any mistakes. And yet what they did was they lulled people into this false sense of security. We've seen pictures of people going down the highway. I think it was in California with a guy totally asleep behind the wheel of a Tesla. People took video and put that up and says, isn't this scary? And it is very scary.
Well, it is very scary, and I find it very interesting. That on the one hand, we are constantly lectured about the need to have ever-escalating safety on a variety of things. And yet here we have something that's demonstrably not just unsafe, but arguably reckless. And there's no hue and cry because, in my opinion, there's political pressure being applied to put these cars into circulation, whereas, you know, if anything that involves us being able to control our cars, that's a different matter.
And that's a key point. You talk about that in your posting Along for the Ride at epautos.com. You talk about, let's talk first about autopilot and why this really is a misnomer.
Well, it's not autopilot. The car is not under your control, but it's under the control of someone. First and foremost, it's under the control of the people who designed the software and put the parameters into the computer that controls everything. And secondarily, it's under the control, potentially, of someone else in real time. People out there may not realize it, but every Tesla that's out in circulation transmits constantly to Tesla, the company, telemetry about your driving, about where you're headed, how fast you're going, and so on. All of these vehicles have that capability, and GM's OnStar system, for example, has that capability, and they can control your car remotely, and I really worry that potentially that is the long-term agenda with these things.
Absolutely. And they want to control not just your car, but they want to control you. You know, when we talk about gun control, we're talking about people control. When we talk about some third party or the government controlling your movement, that ought to make all of us why would people accept that? And yet we see that people really are happy and totally ready for this. They took a poll in New York as well as California, said people are totally ready for autonomous cars. This is the automotive establishment pushing this. This one came from Road and Track, that headline. Said 9 out of 10 New Yorkers, 86% of residents in California think that autonomous cars are a great idea. And there's a picture, I think, of that guy who was asleep in this car.
That may be true for city people in New York and L.A., but I think they've also been sold a bill of goods. I think that they have been marketed a kind of Jetsons view of this future where they'll be whisked along at great efficiency to wherever they want to go. It's not going to be like that. If you think about how traffic laws are right now, and if you think about what government generally does when it controls mobility or controls our access to it, it tends not to be speedy or efficient.
That's right. And you made an excellent point, I think, when you were talking about autopilot and the difference between real autopilot and an airplane. You mentioned the Jetson view of the world. When you're in an airplane, as you pointed out, autopilot, you file your flight plan with them. They keep all other planes a huge distance away from you, not only front and back, but altitude-wise and that sort of thing. So there's a tremendous spatial bubble put around you to correct for any error. And yet you can't do cars that way. Cars are going to be in very close proximity in a real-world environment, and there's going to be a lot of unexpected things flying in there. They freak out about the idea that they've got drones in the air around airports. I mean, that's the real, the analogy would be is if you got, you know, a gazillion drones around the airport as their planes are trying to land, that would be a true analogy to what's going to happen with their self-driving cars.
Well, sure, but let's just, for the sake of discussion, say that it would be technologically feasible to do that. Would we want that?
Yes.
You know, I write often about mobility and its relationship to freedom, and that means our ability to just jump in our car on the spur of the moment, take a trip someplace without filing a flight plan, without getting permission beforehand. I think there is no way that this could be implemented technologically without requiring that everybody basically file a flight plan, and with our movements being not only monitored but completely controlled at all times.
Absolutely. We're going to see that just as we have seen the no-fly list, for example. Even put you on a no-fly list, put you on a watch list, and use that to apply punishments to you. You don't know that you're on the list. You don't know why you're on the list. You're not allowed to confront your accusers in a public and speedy trial. You're not allowed to call witnesses in your defense. They just put you on that list. Yep. Of course, they're going to do that with a car. They're going to apply that kind of punishment to people, and they're going to do it if they say that you owe them money, for example. You owe the IRS or you owe somebody else some money. They will essentially put you under house arrest. It'll be very easy when they control all transportation. You pointed out that once you turn over that control, you said for an automated car to be safe, it's necessary, it is mandatory, that the caprice of human drivers be taken entirely out of the picture. Yep. So get ready. If you want to be safe, turn over all control of your movement to the government forever, forever.
It has to be that way. It's an either-or situation, as these accidents have proved. Either the driver, the human driver, is responsible for maintaining control of the vehicle and being aware of the driving environment and so on, or he's not. You can't have it in the middle.
Absolutely. Let's talk a little bit about some of the crony capitalist aspects of this, because as we see this being investigated, we've already seen some charges, questions brought up about Tesla's S models and their suspension problems. And we learned just the last couple of days that to fix these problems, they were demanding that the owners first sign a non-disclosure agreement, that they not talk about the fact that they're having a problem with this car. That is totally unprecedented in the automotive industry.
To my knowledge, yeah. I've never heard of anything like that happening. And more significantly, and more interestingly, I think, the government apparently isn't too interested in that.
Yes, yes, because...
meanwhile, they're crucifying Volkswagen over a literally fractional difference in tailpipe emissions for their diesel vehicles.
Absolutely. Yeah, you had another interesting comment on that. It was called Bank Run, talking about how they're trying to put Volkswagen out of business. And now we've had the state of California jump in with $86 million, which is like a petty change compared to what the federal government is trying to do to Volkswagen. Talk about that briefly.
Well, this, too, is unprecedented. I think the total liability, the number that's being bandied around now, is something on the order of $80 billion, not million, dollars. Total that will be involved here, not just in terms of the government's fines, but also potential litigation from class action lawsuits. And again, to put that into some kind of perspective, you might recall the Firestone Explorer rollover fiasco that happened back in the 90s.
That's right.
That cost Ford about $24 million. That cost Ford $2.4 billion.
Mm-hmm.
And the prior exploding Pinto fiasco of the 70s, in which there actually were real victims, people who were hurt, that cost the equivalent in today's money of about $24 million.
Wow.
And nobody to date has produced a single actual flesh and blood victim, somebody who can, you know, who can say, hey, I was harmed by the fractionally increased emissions of these Volkswagen cars, which, by the way, would have been fully compliant with all the federal mandates that were in effect for, say, circa 2005 model year cars, and nobody's claiming that those cars hurt anybody either.
Well, here's another one for you, Eric. One of the first stories that I covered when I came here to InfoWars was the EPA hooking people up to diesel tailpipes at the University of North Carolina to try to show that they needed to have more stringent regulations on diesel fumes, on fine particulate matter. And so what they did was they went to Congress, and at the time the head of the EPA was Lisa Jackson, and she did a little dog and pony show that was prearranged with then Congressman Markey from Massachusetts. And he was actually leading her with questions and actually read some of her lines. That's how you know it was all coordinated ahead of time. And basically said, you're not talking about people getting sick here. You're talking about people actually dying from this. And she said, oh, yes. Yes, they will die from fine particulate matter. And very quickly. And it's more people dying from that than are dying from cancer. And then they took their own levels and they exposed people to 72 times their maximum level. And they pre-screened to try to find people who had respiratory and heart issues so they could create an event. And now we've got the same people coming out and saying, we're going to shut down Volkswagen because they disobeyed our laws. And that's really the issue, isn't it? They disobeyed their laws.
They disobeyed their laws. I mean, it's the equivalent, this cheating, and I put it in air quotes, of the emissions test is analogous to you or I having a radar detector in our car to avoid the speed traps. Most people don't realize it, and I wish that Volkswagen had done a better job of explaining it. In fact, I wish the industry generally had done this, but all the low-hanging fruit has already been picked. The tailpipe exhaust emissions of any recent vintage car, whether it's a gas engine car or a diesel engine car, are effectively nil. 95% of what comes out of the tailpipe of a modern car is carbon dioxide and water vapor, both of which are inert gases that have nothing to do whatsoever with asthma or air quality issues. But they don't want to talk about that because then EPA would no longer have a reason to exist.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, when we look at this, we can also, you know, we can see the what many people call the regulatory captures. You pointed out the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration doesn't really want to see anything wrong with these self-driving cars because it fits so well with the government's agenda, you know. And I look at the regular mainstream automotive press, you know, like Car and Driver pushing this stuff, and I'm wondering, who are they going to be selling magazines to? Are they going to have, like, a Bus and Rider magazine in the future, you know?
I wonder what happened to those guys. You know, when I was a kid, I grew up reading guys like Brock Yates, who you probably know about.
Oh, yeah.
You know, guys who not only loved cars and loved mobility, but were car guys and who understood mechanical things and engineering things.
Yeah.
And the people that they've got covering the industry today are nothing like that, you know, except for myself.
Yeah, exactly.
And a couple of other people who have kind of become outliers off the reservation.
Yeah, I remember the motto we had, cogito ergo zoom.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I wish that would fit on a license plate. Let's talk about the regulatory capture, though, with Tesla. Because one of the things I was really surprised when I went back and looked at this was the timeline. This fatal accident that we just recently had of the guy who, now they're saying, no, we don't think he even had autopilot on after this has been going for about 10 days. This happened back on May 4th. And it was 54 days before the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration publicly disclosed those details. In the meantime, you had massive stock movements to the favor of Tesla. You had Goldman Sachs upgrading them to a buy. You had Tesla buying back its stock and making a $1.5 billion profit after they cashed that in so that they could then move on and try to take over Solar City, which is about $2.8 billion. So you've got all these moves that are happening. They know about it. The NTHSA knows about it, but the public doesn't know about it in that time. I think that's pretty telling.
Well, it is, and it's the media's fault for not publicizing that, and it's an open question as to why they don't. It seems that they take at face value everything, every pronouncement that Musk makes is not examined critically and is simply transmitted to the public, whether by print or other forms of media. And it's ridiculous. You know, the company... Musk does not sell cars. He sells carbon credits, which is an elaborate flapdoodle. It's a means by which to mulct the major car companies that do sell functionally viable and economically practical vehicles. In states like California and some other states, there are requirements that every automaker that does business in the state sell a certain percentage of so-called zero-emissions cars. Well, since only electric cars qualify for that, if you, as a car company, do not sell electric cars or do not sell a certain number of electric cars, then you got to buy the carbon credit from somebody like Elon Musk. That's how the guy makes his money.
Exactly. Even though his cars are incredibly expensive, and even though he just had a press conference not too long ago where he said, yeah, their first generation of cars, the Tesla Roadster, was total garbage and unsafe. That was his characterization of it.
To me, it's literally lunatic asylum crazy. You know, they tout these cars for their performance and their advanced technology and their sexiness. Well, you could say the same thing about a Porsche or a Lamborghini. So why aren't we paying people to buy Porsches? Is it not the same thing?
Yeah, yeah. Well, it's all about control. And the government is allied with them tooth and nail because they have always wanted to have control of our transportation. And it's not just the government and these car companies. Of course, it's also Uber. Stay with us. We'll be right back with Eric Peters. Welcome back to the Alex Jones Show. I'm David Knight, and we're talking to Eric Peters of epautos.com about the future of transportation, the future of freedom, quite frankly. Because if you don't have control over your movement, okay, you're essentially locked up. You're under house arrest, and that's what we're moving towards. We've always had the government want to control our transportation, and now they have the perfect vehicle, if you will, for it, the so-called self-driving car. We've been talking to Eric about the recent spate of Tesla crashes, but even before these last three crashes that have been blamed on autopilot, the one where the former Navy SEAL was killed as his car passed under a semi-trailer, 18-wheel truck from the side, we also had before that, we had multiple cases where people reporting that autopilot not only did not do collision avoidance, but it sped up. as it saw the situation developing. And so we have a different approach that's being taken by Tesla to put people out there in a beta test, putting them out there on the road, and they have complete protection from the federal government and its regulatory agencies. They're trying to override any concerns at the state level about the safety of these systems. A different approach is being taken by Google, who say they want to take complete control of your car, no steering wheel, no brakes, that's the only safe way to do that. And, of course, that's what they're eventually going to do because that's what the government wants to do. Before we go back to Eric, real quickly, I want to let you know that we have our Independence Day mega sale ends tonight, and that is the massive discount off of multiple items. We've got 20% off Survival Shield X2, which is about to sell out. We've got 20% off Alexa Pure Air Purifiers, as well as 20% off Alexa Pure water filters. And we have 20 to 40% off InfoWars Select Storable Food. All of that is going to be ending tonight. Also, we have a new product, 25% off Go Smile Sonic Pro Teeth Whitening Toothbrush. You can read about that at InfoWarsStore.com. It's a new product, and we have an introductory special of 25% off. Using Go Smile, you can whiten your teeth up to 7 shades brighter in 30 days. The Go Smile Sonic Toothbrush vibrates an average of 27,000 times per minute for a super deep clean. It's a whitening gel that it uses, as well as a blue wavelength. You can read all about the technology, but you can find that at InfoWarsStore.com. Read about that and take a look at that product. It's now 25% off as an introductory special. Now, Eric, as we're looking at all of this, there's a common thread that I see all the time. As the government wants to take control of our lives, they always promise us that we'll be safer if we just give up our freedom.
Sure.
Let's talk about that a little bit, and let's talk about the false trade-off in light of airbags. That's a good example of how the promise of safety is truly a lie.
Well, it's interesting. You'll hear the phrase used, if it saves even one life, then it's worth doing. Recently, well, I guess within the last 2 years, the feds mandated backup cameras in all new cars because there were a handful, literally a handful, of incidents where somebody didn't look before they backed up and they ran over a kid.
Mm-hmm.
Well, okay, that's you know, well and good. Now, we've got airbags, which have killed people. These are mandated devices that we're forced to have in our cars. There are millions of cars, literally millions of cars out there with these defective Claymore mines in the dashboard that can kill you.
Yes.
I think the current death toll, I think 13 people have been killed. Many more have been severely wounded by these things, and they literally spew shrapnel. You know, people hear the term airbag, and they tend to think, oh, it's a pillowy, soft thing that keeps your face, you know, from being hurt by the steering wheel in a crash. Well, in order for it to work, it has to explode out of the dash with great force. They're very violent. And the engineers made this clear to NHTSA back in the 70s when this was first being proposed, and they were deliberately ignored.
Yeah.
The first-generation airbags proved to be very unsafe. The second-generation airbags were better, but they're more complicated.
We're out of time.
We've got the defective ones in circulation.
We're out of time, Eric. Sorry. Yeah, the bottom line is they won't even let us turn it off even when they know they're defective until they can get it fixed. That's the lie that they keep selling us. Thank you so much. Eric Peters, epautos.com. Join us tonight. InfoWars Nightly News, 7 Central, 8 p.m. Eastern.